Hello and welcome to today's special coverage of the throne speech. This afternoon's speech will be delivered by Governor General Julie Payette. It will be the first time that she delivers a speech from the throne, and it will set the tone for the new minority Liberal government. It's expected to strike a more collaborative tone than the Prime Minister has in the past as he seeks support from opposition parties to maintain his minority government. And we think that we're going to hear a little something for everyone to appeal to all those parties and ensure their support. The Liberals, looking ahead to get support for the speech and anything else in the House, have to carefully calculate how many votes they need. The answer is 32 from the Bloc Québécois MPs or from the NDP, 24 to pass legislation in order to survive confidence votes. Conservative leader Andrew Scheer appears determined to block the Trudeau government at every turn, viewing the new session of Parliament as a chance to continue the election campaign. And he has indicated that he is not looking to support the government on a lot of these issues, although there could be a few things in the throne speech today that we're expecting, including things like small business tax breaks or family tax breaks, and they could be looking at that. At 2:35 Eastern is when we expect things to kick off, but before that happens, let's introduce our panel. With us today in studio, we have Liberal strategist Richard Mahoney, former NDP candidate Emil Tamin, and Conservative strategist Fred DeLory. Also standing by outside the Senate chamber, our very own political correspondent, chief political correspondent, David Aiken. David, tell us a little bit about what you're expecting in the throne speech.
Yeah, well, this is the first throne speech since 2008. That one was read by Mikhail Jean. That kind of means something. And when I say means something, in the sense that the House of Commons will vote on the throne speech, it's a confidence vote. And 2008 was the last time we had a minority government with the throne speech. And if the throne speech fails, we get an election or a new government. We're probably not going to have that because, as you hinted, Mercedes, there is lots of room for the government to try and find some parliamentary partners on all sides. Just before we went to the polls, the Angus Reid Institute had a poll out that said, okay, what are your top issues? And for everybody who did not vote Conservative, that's Liberals, New Democrats, Greens, and the Bloc, the top three issues were identical. Climate change, housing, healthcare. So there's lots in there that the government can say, we're going to do something on climate change, housing, and healthcare, and know they'll find some partners. What about those who voted Conservative? Well, their top three issues, according to Angus Reid, were nothing, none of those three. The top three issues for Conservative voters, my taxes are too high, I'm worried about the deficit, and transparency and ethics in government. Is there something a Trudeau government could do to attach any of those three? Sure. Number one is the tax issue. And we know that in the election campaign, both Liberals and Conservatives campaigned on a big, huge income tax cut that would largely affect middle-income earners and low-income earners. So, Mercedes, you're right. There's lots of room for the government to maneuver to be able to poke and pick and choose on where to go with parliamentary partners, make this a stable minority government. I'll be interested to see in the throne speech what is not in there. What are things that some parties wanted to have? For example, we're certainly not going to expect the government to say we're repealing the carbon tax, and yet we know, we've seen Andrew Scheer and the Conservatives vow that that's got to happen, et cetera, et cetera. So there's going to be some places to pick political fights, but I expect in this first confidence vote of the throne speech, that'll be enough for lots of people to agree on and get this 43rd Parliament off to a stable start.
And David, before we dig further into the issues with our strategist panel, tell us a little bit about where you are at the Senate today, because this is a historic first. The Senate and the House not in the same location, having that vehicle convoy that we're watching and our viewers will be seeing traveling between the House of Commons and the Senate in separate locations. What's different today?
There's a lot different today. Normally, the Senate and the House of Commons are in the center block, the same building. Of course, for folks outside Ottawa, that is where the Peace Tower is, the center block. Center block is going under a massive multi-billion dollar renovation that's going to take a decade. So the Senate of Canada is in this building that I'm standing in now. This used to be the train station for Ottawa, built 100 and some odd years ago. It has been renovated to become the Senate of Canada. So the Senate chamber is here, and the House of Commons, where MPs are gathering, and then they'll come here, they're sort of about 800 or 900 meters west of us in the West Block. So this is the first time ever that we've had a speech from the throne read in this particular building where the Senate is. I'm on the ground floor right now, and you can see the red carpet behind me. It's where Governor General Julie Payette will soon lead a procession, or actually the procession will lead her, and she'll follow up because she's important as the Governor General, and she'll head on into the Senate chamber. You're going to see a lot of sort of big wigs. Pomp and circumstances is the name of the game for a speech from the throne. This is hearkening back to our parliamentary traditions, reminding us we're part of the Westminster tradition. I like it, but I'm a parliamentary geek. It's a lot of fun for me, and it's exciting to be a historic first in the new Senate of Canada building, Mercedes.
Thanks, David. And just for our viewers who are watching there, that is the Prime Minister and his wife, Sophie Gregoire Trudeau, arriving. They are receiving the salute from the Honor Guard, and they are heading over now. They're about to be greeted by the Usher of the Black Rod. You're going to see his ceremony. Quite something to behold. And you can see there, of course, Royal Canadian Mounted Police officers outside. Chief of the Defence Staff is there. All kinds of dignitaries from across Canada. Richard, as we watch this unfold and this ceremony, you're very familiar with this history and how it all works. What's the significance of what we're seeing here?
That's such a good question, Mercedes, because for a lot of folks at home, they'll look at it and go, what is this pomp and circumstance all about?
What are these weird outfits?
And carrying around maces and things like that. They are the symbols of authority. They are the symbols of democracy. They're the symbols of the way our government works and our traditions from various places around the globe. And what's important about it is that continuity, that stability, that's rule of law and order, and that is what makes Canada such a great place to live, that we have a place that essentially functions. We've always all find things wrong with how we do it, but functions very well. Our economy works well because we have rule of law, because we have democratic institutions, and all these things that we're seeing today, including the new Senate and the new House of Commons, are all symbols of that continuity, of that order, of that rule of law.
Emily, when you're looking ahead to today's speech, and we don't know exactly what's in it yet, but we have a sense, is there anything in particular that the NDP are going to be looking for to be present in this speech? We heard from David what we're expecting the Liberal government to likely put in it, but I'd imagine the NDP has been lobbying hard behind the scenes to have some of your priorities there.
Yeah, I think a couple of the priorities, no surprise, will probably be a pharmacare program, looking for a universal single-payer pharmacare program. We saw during the election campaign, Bill Morneau in particular, starting to use the phrase universally accessible pharmacare, or, you know, kind of like tinkering with language. I don't think we're going to see, you know, a full plan laid out, but that would certainly be an important priority for Canadians and for New Democrats. I think on the question of reconciliation, the ongoing litigation with the First Nations Family and Caring Society, compensation for First Nation kids that was awarded by the Human Rights Tribunal, I think we'll, you know, really be hoping to see a signal that that litigation is going to come to an end and that the fair compensation can be paid. And then, of course, how is the Prime Minister going to balance the demand for ambitious action on climate change with the calls from the West in particular for resource development and pipelines? So how is that balance going to be struck? That'll be something that we'll be interested to see, I think.
Fred, Andrew Scheer has taken a more combative tone looking towards this. Is there anything that could be offered in this speech by the Liberals that would convince the Conservatives to vote in favour of it, or is it absolutely off the table as an option?
Well, I think, you know, we'll have to see what's in this speech. There is opportunity, of course, to reach out to the other side. You'd have to include some of the things that we've asked to be in the throne speech, including tax relief for Canadians, as well as a task force that we've asked to be put together on a national energy corridor. We have a major national unity situation right now where Alberta and Saskatchewan do not have any members in the Liberal caucus, the governing caucus, and their main priorities and issues right now is economic issues there, and those need to be addressed. If those are in there, I'm sure the Conservatives will give that a good look. I doubt it will be in there. I doubt there'll be a real reach out to these people, and we'll see what's in this.
Richard, just as we're waiting, the Governor General is expected to arrive at any moment. Of course, she actually reads the speech from the throne, even though it's written by the Prime Minister and his staff, as per our tradition. But there's a new speaker in the House. This is the first thing that had to happen today, is that the MPs elected a new speaker in the House of Commons. Last speaker was Jeff Regan. Well-liked guy, well-known. He ran again. He didn't get it. A bit of a surprise upset with Mr. Rota getting it. What can you tell us about the new speaker?
Yeah, I was a bit surprised, too, by that for the same reasons. So I've known Nancy Rota for a long time. He is, first and foremost, a real gentleman. He is almost, I was saying before we went on the air to my colleagues here, I've often thought that Anthony's one of those people that's almost too nice for politics because the game can get a little tough in the corners.
Bit of a blood sport.
Bit of a blood sport, but wise, calm, thoughtful, humble servant who believes in public service and, you know, has been a member for a number of times. I think he'll probably be a very good speaker because he has a lot of those qualities will serve him well as he tries to herd the cats a little bit, or at least keep them well behaved. And I note that in his speech, he went there right away. So very dignified individual. I think he'll be a really good speaker.
David Aiken, I want to bring you in on this because our prime political correspondent, also parliamentary nerd, as you self-identified, so I feel I can say that. What did you think of the fact that Anthony Rota became the speaker and beat Jeff Regan, who a lot of people said they liked, who did a good job, and a surprise upset? I know certainly in the newsroom we were all surprised by that result.
Yeah, actually, a lot of people said he did not do a good job, but a lot of those people happen to be Conservative MPs, and there's 121 of them. Conservatives felt that Jeff Regan too much, when he was Speaker, protected the Prime Minister from tough questions, from heckles. They did not like the fact, when I say they, the Conservatives, did not like the fact that Jeff Regan would admonish by name Conservative MPs all the time. And when I say by name, they called up by the member for so-and-so, the member for Calgary, Skyview, or whatever it might be. But those Conservative MPs, Michael Cooper, Ron Liepert, James Bazan, were getting singled out by Regan, and they didn't see Regan singling out anybody else. And so Conservatives did not vote for Regan. And this was a Regan, pardon me, this was a ranked ballot. So there's five candidates, and you rank 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And so what I was told, that Conservatives basically ranked as their number one choice a guy named Bruce Stanton, who is the deputy speaker. He's a Conservative. And their number two choice was Anthony Rota, the Liberal from North Bay. On the Liberal benches, it was a combination. I talked to some Liberals who thought Anthony Rota had a great speech, and he did have a good speech, so it was Regan or Rota who were the one and two on the Liberal side. The New Democrats, same view that the Conservatives had. They thought that Regan sometimes protected the Prime Minister too much. Their number one was their candidate, Carol Hughes, and their number two was Anthony Rota. So you can see what happened here is after the first ballot, nobody had a majority, because we have a minority government. And after the second ballot, that's when all the votes for Rota from the Conservatives, Rota from the NDP, swamped anything on the Liberal side for Regan. And that's how Anthony Rota ended up as the Speaker of the House. And maybe that's a message I think that he knows he's going to take is, the last Speaker, a Liberal, was seen as too protective of the Liberal Prime Minister. And as Anthony Rota said in his speeches, he has to remember he serves the House first and foremost, and not anybody's particular political agenda. So there was some politics there, and again, if you're the parliamentary nerd, that's what that election of the Speaker
was
all about.
And as we're talking about this, I just want to let our viewers know we're watching the Governor General arrive, Governor General Julie Payette. She was appointed by this government. This will be the first throne speech that she reads as the Governor General. The last one was read by Governor General David Johnston. Always kind of sounded like he was reading a storybook. A lot of people enjoyed his speeches. His nickname was Grandpa Book when he used to read. So this will be the first chance that we hear from a new Governor General. And it's always a historic occasion when we have a chance to hear that speech. There is the salute beginning to the Governor General. And a little chance here to take in a bit of the music and a bit of the history that we see on Parliament Hill. That is one of the local artillery regiments providing the salute. They're here in Ottawa for all of the big events, Remembrance Day, some major celebrations, and of course today for the throne speech. And there is the Canadian flag high up in the sky flying as we prepare to hear what is going to happen in this country, where this government is going to take us after this 21-gun salute.
Okay!
Fred, as we're watching this unfold and we're waiting for the speech to get underway, David was mentioning that some of the Conservative MPs were not fans of Mr. Regan. that they wanted somebody new. Interesting to me that the number two choice was a Liberal. Was there a sense that really this, at the end of the day, was likely going to be a Liberal speaker?
To be honest, I'm very disappointed with this result. I do agree that Jeff Regan, a lot of conservatives were concerned with his approach as speaker. But this was an opportunity for us to send a message to all the opposition parties that this is a minority parliament, and we should have put in a member of the opposition, sorry, in the speaker's chair, whether it be a conservative or an NDP. I think we'd all agree it shouldn't be a bloc. But I think it was a real missed opportunity from the opposition parties. I think people should be asked about that, how that happened.
Okay, we're just taking a little bit more here of the Governor General reviewing the troops here. It's always a big moment for those in uniform when they have a chance to be at something like this, represent their country, and to be a part of history right on the front lines there. And there's a number of VIPs who are there, of course, Chief of the Defense Staff. We saw the Supreme Court justices taking their seats just a few moments ago. It's a very limited seating inside this chamber, which not everyone realizes. In fact, a lot of MPs aren't even there. They couldn't fit in the minibus convoy that will be bringing people from one end of parliamentary precinct to the other with this new building that they're housed in. But there are certain people who are there by tradition. They're there to witness it. And of course, now, thank you to the wonder of technology, we all witness it as well. But it's certainly that reminder of the key elements and institutions in Canada that are represented there today. Emily, I'm wondering, when you're looking at this parliament as the NDP, the Bloc obviously expected to have a lot of influence. Some people think that the knees have been taken out from the NDP. They're not going to have the same ability to push as they'd hoped for. What do you think are the big priorities here that you'll be looking for in the throne speech? You mentioned pharmacare is one that you expect, as well as Indigenous reconciliation. But are there certain things that absolutely have to be on the agenda, or you won't support the government?
I mean, I think we're really looking for concrete measures that are going to improve the quality of life of people who are really struggling. So, you know, the emphasis in the rhetoric on supporting the middle class, that's important. Obviously, we want to have a strong, prosperous middle class, but that there are too many people in our country and right here in our city that are struggling to find adequate housing, who are struggling to make ends meet, who are using food banks despite working full time. These are really unacceptable metrics, I think. And so we're going to be looking to see not just platitudes and not just words, but actual concrete actions. Now, are we going to see all of that in the throne speech? No, we're not going to see that. We're going to probably see, a lot of nice words around those issues. But I think in the coming weeks and months, this is what we're going to want to be looking for. And, you know, in all of the discussion about who holds the balance of power, how and when and where, it's not just about, you know, is the NDP in a position to make the government fall, yes or no, but it's also going to be, eventually this government is going to have to run on a record. And I'm not sure that the Liberals are going to want to go into the next election having relied very heavily on the Bloc Québécois and the Conservatives to hold on in the interim.
Richard, you've been on the inside. Tell us a little bit about what goes into crafting a speech like today's, particularly in a minority situation. It was very different for Justin Trudeau last time. They had a significant majority mandate. They could have put anything they wanted into that speech.
Right.
It was really a speech about change. Now you don't have the change element. You have your own record, and you have to be sensitive to the fact that they don't have complete control. So how does one determine what goes into it? What do you have to include to make sure you keep people on side? What do you have to include to prove that you're still on your own agenda and not being completely controlled by opposition parties?
So much in there to unpack, I think. First of all, I think the most obvious answer is you have to obviously, in large measure, stay true to the things that you have said you were going to do yourselves. So, we're going to hear a lot in the speech, I'm sure, about the principles around helping the middle class get ahead, about getting more resources to them, that we have a polarizing of income in this country where those that make a lot of money are doing well, but those in lower and middle income are struggling. So you'll see some work on that. Building on some of the work they did in the first term, I believe this election was about many things, but more than almost anything else, there was a consensus, as you indicated at the top, on climate change. You're going to see some action and commitment in the throne speech on that. And then I think a bunch of those things that come from the Liberal commitments. And the second thing is the other thing you mentioned, which is, if there's one other message from the election other than the fact that the 63 or 64% of us wanted action on climate change and on the middle class, it is this. It is that they want us all to work together. They sent a minority parliament back. So you've seen the Prime Minister since the election refrain from a lot of the campaigning and politicking that we don't like so much as Canadians, and you've seen him meeting with opposition leaders, you've seen him meeting with premiers, you've seen him meeting with mayors, you've seen the ministers doing the same. So you're going to have to do, as you said in your question, you're going to have to put some things in there which are obviously come out of those discussions. So work on a city's agenda, I think, might make it in there. As Emily mentioned, I think there'll be a tip of the hat of some kind on the principle of pharmacare. The details will be negotiated with provinces and probably with parliamentary parties, but you're going to see a lot of collaboration in there. And will that work? The last part of your question, in the long run, I'm sure there will be lots of partisan divisions, but I think in the beginning, if he'll make an honest attempt to do it, and there'll probably be a couple of examples with the NDP, maybe with the Bloc, and maybe even with the Conservatives on pipelines, where we actually see some cross-partisan progress.
Okay, and just so our viewers can have a chance to listen to this and know what they're listening to, this is the Governor General. She is enjoying a performance by the Ottawa River Signers, a group of 5 First Nations signers and drummers. Take a listen to this. Performance there by First Nations singers and drummers for the Governor General. And that's going to be a theme that we expect to continue to hear, that we've seen more and more, that reflection of Indigenous heritage in this country, whether it's at cabinet swearings in, at cabinet shuffles, throne speeches, opportunities to reflect on that Indigenous heritage. And we expect that to be a priority for this government. They've said it's a priority before, Richard. They were criticized, though, by some First Nations groups who said, look, you overpromised and underdelivered. Where do you think that fits on the agenda in terms of not just words, but action to try to provide a better quality of life for Canada's First Nations and Indigenous people.
So I think it fits pretty high on the agenda, and I think it's fair to say that, you know, they've received criticism for not moving fast enough. This is something that is a historical reality for Canadians. Even when governments are well-intentioned, as I believe the last government was and this government was, there are some complex things at work here that are not easy to wave a magic wand and solve. Now, so they made some serious progress on things like water quality. The work of agreements and things like that, and this is longer work. This entails lots of parties agreeing to things, provincial governments, First Nations, authorities and so forth. So I think it'll be high up. I think you'll see some more work on reconciliation. But the reality is this is going to be the work of every government for the foreseeable future, not just this one. I think it's a high up on their priority list, and I think you'll see lots of accomplishments. But I think the government after this and the one after this are all going to have to continue to do that work.
Well, and it's certainly something that, many expect to be multi-generational, but there is an urgency here too, Emily, in terms of getting things done quickly, especially on things like safe, clean drinking water.
That's right. And I think, you know, of course, this is a long-term project, but not all of the solutions that are needed are particularly complex. And I would just refer back again to this issue of the Human Rights Tribunal finding an unequal funding for First Nation children's education, healthcare, and the child welfare system being discriminatory. And the government, Trudeau's government, you know, was subject to 8 or 9 non-compliance orders by the Human Rights Tribunal on the basis of actually relatively straightforward measures, that it's just a question of topping up the funding. Now, there are more complex things that need to happen over time, but I think we need to be really careful not to use that as an excuse for failing to take the measures that have been identified as being, you know, capable of being taken in the shorter term. And the fact that this litigation is ongoing and that the government is appealing the compensation order, I think, is concerning. And that is something they could do in the short term that would be more than just, you know, symbols. That would be actually something concrete the government could do to show a true commitment to remedying these inequities that are not only historic but are actually also ongoing.
And just for those who are joining us at home or just tuning in so you know what you're looking at here, we are looking inside the brand new Senate chamber. A couple of remarkable things here. This is the first time that we will have a speech from the throne in this Senate chamber. It is no longer in the same building as the House of Commons. Parliament is now separated in two separate buildings. This used to be an old train station. It was renovated for years, and it is now where the Senate is. Very limited seating there, a lot of VIPs. And we're going to be watching in just a few moments when the procession comes down the aisle. But let's talk a little bit about the tone that we're expecting to hear in this speech. David Akin, our chief political correspondent, is over there at the Senate. He's ready to bring us the play-by-play as this all goes ahead. David?
Yeah, Mercedes, what I was going to talk about was after the Speaker's election, all the party leaders have already given their first speech in the House of Commons. It's part of the tradition. After you elect the Speaker, then each leader stands up and says a couple of nice words about the Speaker. But what I found interesting was this is where the first chance for these leaders to set some markers about, okay, how are we going to get along in this new minority parliament? And certainly that's one of the things the Prime Minister talked about, Justin Trudeau, saying, you know, we're all here, we got the message, it's a minority, we all have to get along. I didn't find anything too remarkable in what he said. Andrew Scheer, who has been, of course, a former speaker himself, talked about essentially the role of the Speaker and also promised there'd be cooperation. One of the more interesting speeches I found was from the Bloc Cable Quad leader in Canada, get ready to get to know Yves-François Blanchet. His speech essentially was saying, yes, I'm the leader of the Bloc Québécois and I am here with a Quebec first approach, but it doesn't mean I'm anti anything. I'm not anti Canada. We're not here to block Canadian growth. And so I took that, or if I was the Prime Minister, I certainly would have taken that by saying, okay, let's make sure we look at our legislative agenda, making sure that, you know, all boats are being lifted, which would necessarily include Quebec. So that, I think, is also sort of part of the, you know, the initial sort of negotiations, the dance that we're going to see. Because, of course, the other thing is, too, is we know that the New Democrats certainly do not want an election right now, or certainly within at least the first year. The Bloc Québécois, Monsieur Blanchet, has also said not interested in an election right now. He wants to see things getting to work. And so to the extent that we know some parliamentary partners are not keen for an election, maybe the Liberals can be a little bit more aggressive, push a little bit more on their side, call a bluff, perhaps, when they need to, knowing that some of those parliamentary partisans just really can't push them off the edge. That's the sort of thing, if there, for instance, has to be money for, say, a Trans Mountain pipeline expansion. There's legislative ways to carve that out of a budget, so it would just be maybe the Conservatives voting on that. In any event, one of the unique things this morning from those speeches, the tone saying, we get it, it's a minority, we are going to have to cooperate here and there through this parliament.
Well, and as we're watching here, the last-minute preparations before the formal processions enter the chamber. You saw Madame Grégoire Trudeau taking her seat, the Speaker, the Leader of the Opposition in the Senate, the Facilitator of the Independent Senators Group, which used to be the Liberal Caucus in the Senate, the Leader of the Canadian Senators Group, and Senator Joseph Day, all escorted by the Senate Pages. They're entering the chamber and taking their seats. This is sort of the last of the VIPs to slide in, and we're seeing a few recognizable Canadian faces who are there to watch this. And there we see the hat being donned as we prepare for this. And an opportunity, Fred, for a new tone. Apart from the policies, what kind of a tone do you think needs to be struck here?
Well, I think Mr. Trudeau needs to realize this is a minority parliament. He doesn't have a majority. So hopefully he will demonstrate that throughout his tenure. Of course, the reality is, as David pointed out, the NDP and the Bloc do not want an election anytime soon. So there are many things Mr. Trudeau can do to be aggressive and to force through what he wants to get done. And I think those parties will find ways to make it happen, whether they sit on their hands or they find ways to hold their nose over certain things. But hopefully it is a tone where the tone is to make this parliament work and to get things done for Canadians. I know Conservatives are looking, hopefully, that there's going to be some things in there that will appeal to us.
This obviously is something that the government has to make an impression with, but also maybe not something that they want big surprises in, Richard. Sometimes with a majority, that's when you get a sense of they're going to do something people didn't expect. When people have been talking about the speech today, I haven't had the sense that anybody is expecting to be astounded by something that's in there.
No, I don't. I think that's right. I don't. I haven't seen it, but I don't think we will be surprised. Maybe the tone will be a surprise to some people, only because they're in their memories they'll remember the tones of the election campaign, which were not exactly collaborative.
So you think this will be quite collaborative?
I do. And I think it's not just, Fred's right to say the Prime Minister has to do that, but all the leaders have to do that. I mean, I would argue Mr. Scheer's constant harping for another election is offside where Canadians' heads are at. There aren't a lot of Canadians calling for another election. We just had one. So what they want us to do, all of us, is to get to work on governing and find collaboration, common ground, find those kind of things where they can work together on issues. Disagree on some, that's fine, but get done what you need to get done and find, there'll be responsibility on each of them. Obviously, it's the biggest on the Prime Minister to collaborate, but it's not just him.
And what do you think, in terms of your respective parties, your leaders need to do to respond? Because it is true, it does have to come from all sides. Do you think, first of all, I guess let's start with this, that Justin Trudeau can strike a humble tone, albeit he's not the one actually reading the speech. But do you think that that's something that he's going to acknowledge? Because there was some criticism after the election that they said that they heard the election results, but people didn't feel that the tone or the actions were matching up with that message. Before we go to that, I want to draw our attention to the fact that the procession is about to enter the chamber. So we will be bringing that to you. This should be quite the procession to watch. Here they come, walking for the first time through the Senate. And let's take a look at the order of who's in this procession. You can see as they're walking there, up front, the Usher of the Black Rod, followed by the Secretary to the Governor General, Military Advisor to the Governor General, because, of course, she is actually the representative of the sovereign here. The way that the Canadian government works, very different than the way that the American government works, so the Governor General representing the Queen, and there she is, getting ready to read her first throne speech. Immediately behind her, of course, is Prime Minister Justin Trudeau. Following him, the government's representative in the Senate. Here they are turning the corner. There goes Peter Harder. He's about to retire, by the way, from his job. And behind him, the Commissioner of the RCMP, Brenda Luckey, and the Chief of the Defence Staff, General Jonathan Vance. And once they enter the chamber, everyone will rise. We're going to hear some fanfare, some trumpets, I expect, typically. Yep, there we go.
On cue.
Huissier de Batonnois, rendez-vous à la Chambre des communes et informez-la que c'est le plaisir de son Excellence le Gouverneur Général que les communes se rendent immédiatement auprès d'elle dans la salle, dans la salle du Sénat.
Okay, so we've just seen the procession enter the chamber there. We're getting ready at this point to hear the speech, and we're watching people marching back out there. This is, of course, the procession of the Usher of the Black Rod. It's very dramatic to watch. Those are members you just so go by in uniforms that some Canadians may not recognize. That's the Parliamentary Protective Service, and they are relatively new. They came, of course, after the attack on Parliament Hill in 2014, the shooting that happened up there. They have their own unique uniforms, and they are run by the RCMP, but their own separate force, which is in keeping with Canadian parliamentary tradition and British parliamentary tradition, that Parliament must have its own police force so that the Prime Minister cannot co-opt the national police force to come in and take over government. Not something we've ever really had to worry about here in Canada, but an interesting little historic fact about why there is a separate police force, and in fact to the point where the RCMP could not bring their firearms into the House of Commons until after what happened in October of 2014. We're going back now to the inside of the chamber. You can see here people chatting a little bit just before the speech as they prepare, and we'll have a chance to hear this very soon. There's the Governor General making some small talk, and we'll just have a few moments to take all of this in. As you watch this and reflect back on past throne speeches, Emily, what's going through your mind?
The anticipation is killing me. No, I mean, I think, you know, the point that you made earlier about tone is interesting because, as you pointed out, it's not the Prime Minister delivering his words, it's the Governor General. And so how is she going to be able to convey the tone that the Prime Minister intends through his words will be, of course, interesting to see, especially given, as we've identified, the importance of, you know, maybe a conciliatory tone or a more collaborative tone. So how will that be achieved by the Governor General if indeed, you know, that's what the words are going to convey? That will be certainly something interesting to look at. I think it's also important to remember that the Prime Minister has to be careful because it's easier for Parliament to hold him accountable, you know, for the commitments that he makes in the throne speech. And it's certainly, I recall clearly in 2015, a renewed commitment to electoral reform that found its way into the throne speech but never materialized in the government's agenda. anyway, was never implemented. And so this is something that I think also you have to be a little bit more careful about in a minority government.
And here we're watching the usher of the Black Rod, accompanied by the Parliamentary Protective Service, marching back out to a vehicle. This is very unusual. This is a first because, as we were saying before, the Senate is no longer in the same building as the House of Commons. You used to see them march down the halls of Parliament from one side to the other. Now you have to go outside in Canada in the winter and get in a van and transport. So this is a little different, isn't it?
It is. It is. And for quite some time. They're talking 10 years, but I think those of us who are, let's call it veteran Ottawa observers, maybe cynics, I think it may be a bit longer than 10 years before the center block is restored.
It's
hopefully not.
Hopefully not, but I suspect, given how long the repairs on West Block took,
right,
and center block is more complicated. But it's really interesting to think that, you know, right now to us this is new. To another generation, this will be where it's always been. And how things change as we watch these same historic occasions play out again and again, but in different places with different people, but the tradition remains the same for it.
Yeah, no, it is a very interesting thing to watch. It's a very cool thing to watch. I was interested today coming in, seeing how they would do it. I wasn't sure, you know, the way the old way was, the MPs would walk from the chamber to the Senate. So I wondered, were they going to grab their coats and all head down to the new Senate building or what? So it is fascinating to see all this.
Today you'd need toques as well.
Right. Yeah,
it's a cold day in Ottawa.
And I believe that now the usher of the Black Rod is heading back to the chamber of the House of Commons, which is why you're seeing him in that bus going west. You can see the house there off in the distance. Here he is turning on to Parliament Hill. This is all part of it. If people are wondering, why are we watching this van driving around? Lovely van.
It's a great van.
Very important van. Very precious cargo inside. And that is the usher of the Black Rod, who is heading back up to the House of Commons, which is a part of this whole process. And that's why we're watching it, because this is actually an official procession, even though it doesn't really look like it. And there behind them, you can see what you don't normally see. That's some of the RCMP protection. You can see on the front of that vehicle, there's a big metal mount that tells you it's usually RCMP emergency response teams in those vehicles. They're low profile on Parliament Hill, but it's always something that they are thinking about, security, because you have the Prime Minister, the Governor General, the heads of the Senate, the senior members of Cabinet, the Commissioner of the RCMP, the Chief of the Defence Staff.
Defence Staff, pretty well everybody.
They're all in one building.
Yeah.
So that is obviously a big day, and certainly security's tight, although we're fortunate in Ottawa that they do generally a very good job of appearing low profile. It's not overt. And here we have the Parliamentary Protective Service hopping out of the van, and behind them we're going to have, of course, the usher of the Black Rod as he makes his way to the door of the House of Commons. And you're going to see there we go. He's heading up. And that is West Block, which is now where the House of Commons is located. The new chamber there, which we didn't get a lot of a chance to see before the election, yeah. A few months before MPs left and sort of started operating out of there in January and out by June. So this will be a whole new session in that new area. And here's the procession coming towards the House of Commons. And the reason why he is heading back, he being the usher of the Black Rod, is to summon MPs. So this is a critical part of the process. What is he summoning the MPs for, Richard? Sounds very serious.
Discipline, I hope.
Oh, here's the knock. That is the historic knock. It's always three times using the Black Rod of the usher of the Black Rod.
Doesn't get used a lot, the Black Rod.
It does not in there.
Message to Son Excellence, the Governor General. A message from Her Excellency, the Governor General.
That is the sergeant at arms. He is in charge of security for the House of Commons.
Mr. Speaker, a message from Her Excellency the Governor General. Monsieur le Président, a message to Son Excellence la Gouverneur Général.
Admit the messenger. Faites entrer le messager.
Mr. Speaker, it is the pleasure of Her Excellency the Governor General that this Honorable House attend her immediately in the Chamber of the Senate. Monsieur le Président, c'est le plaisir de Son Excellence, le Gouverneur Général, que cette Honorable Chambre se rende immédiatement auprès d'elle dans la salle du Sénat.
What we're seeing now is the procession from the House of Commons. These are the members of Parliament who will be taking in the speech at the Senate. Not everyone can fit. So, a limited number who will follow the usher of the Black Rod back out. Another procession back to the Senate where they came from, and this will be the elected members of the House of Commons there to take in the speech as we watch them parading out. You see the brand new Speaker of the House of Commons there, Anthony Rota. Day one on the job. Very busy immediately after you've been elected to be in your first procession there. The clerk and deputy clerk, as well as the House of Commons and the members of Parliament who have been selected to travel there today and to take this in. And again, normally this is a much faster procedure because it's just happening back and forth. In this case, they do have the road, and we can see it from our studio as we look down. It's open at the moment, but they will shut it down when this procession moves through, something people in Ottawa are used to with the VIP processions and the motorcades that we get here. But a unique day today, Wellington Street will open up. So this procession can go through unfettered because, of course, ceremonially and democratically, it's very important that those MPs are there before the speech. And here they are loading into the vans. Before we went to the Senate, we were talking about the tone and how important tone and messaging is, Fred, in this speech. Do you think that Andrew Scheer will soften his tone if he sees evidence that the Prime Minister is softening his tone through the words of the Governor General today?
I would hope so. If there's real words in this speech, if there's real concrete measures, what Mr. Scheer's been asking for, there was 7 items that he put out that he would like to have seen covered in there, including tax relief for middle class, real use of part of our environment plan, real concrete action on that, as well as the task force on the National Energy Corridor. So if that stuff's included, then I'm sure he would, I would hope he would, change his tone and work constructively with this government. But again, I don't expect to see much in this speech from Mr. Trudeau that would appeal to conservatives.
What we're seeing now, just for those who are wondering, these white buses filled with members of Parliament will be traveling to the Senate. Normally those white buses drive people around the parliamentary precinct. useful in Ottawa when it's minus 40 in the winter. And today they have a very different purpose. This is a historic first. We have never had the procession going down the street with buses before, back and forth. Very different way of doing things. And one that, as you were saying, we'll continue to see for years going forward. Richard, when the Prime Minister is there today and he's preparing to hear his speech, how final do you think it ever is? I mean, they have it all written out. They know where they're going with. But how down to the last minute is it with something like this kind of a throne speech? Is it pretty clear from the beginning they know what they need to do? Or is there a lot of negotiating with the opposition parties in a minority situation like this? Do they make calls? Do they call Jagmeet Singh and Andrew Scheer and say, look, we're prepared to offer this? Is there any kind of a negotiation like that in advance?
I suspect not a lot, but some. I don't know what happened in this particular instance. I know that his office has been busy writing it for some time. But I think the Prime Minister quite deliberately met with the opposition leaders, told them these are the kinds of things that I'm thinking about. Then the opposition leaders said, well, these are the kind of things that, you know, we'd like to see in there. So I think there may have been, I suspect because this is a new parliament, there wasn't a huge intention amongst the NDP and the Bloc to, you know, drive us to an election campaign right away, because I don't think that's something that would be wise to do. But I suspect there's a bit of negotiation and some signaling back and forth. But I doubt there's a lot of last minute tweaks in this, because I think, as you have observed and others around the table have observed, there was a lot of potential for common ground, whether it be middle-class tax relief, whether it be action on health care, whether it be action on First Nations. There's a lot of things that whether it be action on a price on carbon and climate change. Those were in a lot of the party's platforms. So there's more common ground than we probably as Canadians think, given the intensity of that election campaign.
Well, and as we try to think of what might be in this speech, and everyone has their crystal ball out, sometimes we can get a hint by who some of the special guests are who have been invited. And I'm looking at a list of some of those guests. They include a lot of Indigenous leaders, including regional chiefs, Perry Bellegarde, of course, the Grand Chief for the AFN, Nathan Obed, President of the ITK. Also, we're seeing in here people like Tim Ross, Executive Director of the Co-op Housing Federation of Canada, Tim Richter, the CEO of the Canadian Alliance to End Homelessness. I see a number of people from municipalities, Canadian Federation of Municipalities. We saw before some northern premiers there. Does that give us a sense of some of the things that we can expect to hear, Emily?
I mean, I think really the election campaign gave us a pretty good sense of what we can expect to hear. I think, you know, the real test is going to be the first budget of this parliament, because the throne speech is going to be, I expect anyway, relatively high level. It's going to touch on a relatively wide range of priorities. And it has the benefit, if you're the government, of being sufficiently vague that you'd have to be pretty deeply offended by it to want the entire government to fall this soon after an election over the words in the throne speech, right? And I think, again, I just want to bring it back to, I think for New Democrats anyway, and I suspect for most members of parliament, we're a lot more concerned with action than we are simply with words. And so, you know, this is, yes, it's tone, it sends some signals, it sends some messages, but the real test is going to be the budget. So just for example, on the pharmacare piece, we won't really know what it is that this government is committing to, regardless of what it says in the throne speech, until we see, you know, a dollar amount attached to a commitment on pharmacare. So I think, you know, for me, I'll be particularly interested to see what the budget looks like, because I think that's where we're going to see the level of more granular detail that is going to really let us know what the true priorities of this government are.
And this is just the arrival now. They're back.
They're back.
They're back at the Senate now. And there is the Usher of the Black Rod, Parliamentary Protective Service. The MPs will be arriving behind them shortly. And once everybody's there, and we'll take a look at that procession in just a moment, and has made their way in, that's when we really start to see things get underway. Fred, big picture on this for Canadians. It seems very formalized. It's a non-elected official reading the speech, but how significant is this moment in every government when they come into power, even if it's a re-elected government, in terms of setting the course? How closely do they stick to their throne speeches?
Right. Well, that's a good question, because a lot of times they disappear quickly, these speeches. They're given, they're important, they set the tone, and then something happens. I remember, I think it might have been 2008 when we were re-elected Conservative government. We had a throne speech that included changing the words of the national anthem to make it more gender neutral. And the blowback was significant. I remember at the party headquarters, we were getting, the phones were ringing off the hook. People were very upset. So we quickly forgot about that part of the speech.
Kind of like electoral reform for the
Liberals. right. So there's a lot of things. It is important that it sets a tone and it shows what their blueprint may be, but of course they can deviate quickly off of it.
I just want to go to David Akin, who's over there at the Senate. David, can you give us a little bit of a sense of the feeling in the air there right now, the anticipation ahead of this speech?
Yeah, well, we're all sort of excited, and I'm going to have to be quiet in just a second because no talking as the procession comes by. So I'm just looking behind me. I don't want to get in trouble with the guy with the mace. That mace is used for a purpose. Exactly. But you're seeing right behind me, these are MPs. They're as excited as we all are. We got a mix of conservatives and liberals and new Democrats and some folks from the Bloc. We're all waiting to see what's in the throne speech. There isn't room in the Senate chamber for all 338 MPs. And so we sort of got about, 100, 120. That's the room in, that will stand at the bar in the Senate. And that's what happened in the old chamber as well, that when we just walked down in the old center block, MPs will sort of stand there. And so there's often a good, strong encouragement for the Governor General. Don't make it too long, because everybody's kind of standing around at the back. It's a very packed chamber. You've seen the pictures of it, of course. The Supreme Court justice is down front. It gets very warm in that chamber. So we think the speech will be about 30 minutes, and that's about how far it should go.
David, do we have any sense of how these MPs were selected? Was this something the parties made a choice on? Did people get to volunteer themselves? Oh, and I see the procession coming there, so you probably don't have a chance to answer that.
We can make up his answer.
Let's take a look at this procession as it enters. MPs there. It's a solemn occasion, but more of one that is filled with excitement than just seriousness. It's quite a beautiful building, the new Senate. The way that they've renovated it is very grand. I remember it as the old train station. It looked very different. It was always a lovely, historic building in Ottawa, but incredible to see it unfolding for the first time here. And we've been so used to seeing everybody walking down the walls of Centre Block, the halls of Centre Block, and seeing that very different image here.
I'm really glad that they've actually taken this historic building in Ottawa, which, as you say, was a real centre public place. It was the train station. It fell into disuse for a while. It almost became Canada Sports Hall of Fame at one point.
That would have been a very different look than this.
A very different look. And then the government took it back as a sort of a meeting room conference center. And then for the renovations, the House of the Senate. So it looks, it's beautiful inside. It really is.
And here is the usher of the Black Rod entering the Senate chamber. His position in front of the Governor General and opposite the Speaker of the Senate. He's going to turn and face the bar now. And next we are expecting the arrival of the members of the House of Commons. The
order!
MPs. There we go. And we will soon see the newly elected Speaker of the House of Commons standing at the dais. He will greet the Governor General, and you'll hear that exchange. Anthony Rota, Liberal MP, just elected today to that position.
Wearing his hat.
Oh, there you go. There's the speech, or the exact comments. These are very precise comments he's going to read.
May it please Your Excellency, the House of Commons has elected me their Speaker. Though I'm but little able to fulfill the important duties thus assigned to me, if the performance of those duties I should at any time fall into error, I pray the fault may be imputed to me and not to the Commons, whose servant I am, and who through me the better to enable them to discharge their duties to their Queen and country, humbly claim all their undoubted rights and privileges, especially that they may have freedom of speech in their debates, access to their excellency's person at all seasonable times, and that their proceedings may receive from your excellency the most favorable construction. Qu'il plaît à votre excellence, la chambre des...
Mr. Speaker, I am commanded by Her Excellency the Governor General, so I am but little able to fulfill the important duties thus assigned to me. If in the performance of those duties I should at any time fall into error, I pray that the fault may be imputed to me and not to the Commons, whose servant I am, and who, through me, the better to enable them to discharge their duty to their queen and country, humbly claim all their undoubted rights and privileges, especially that they may have freedom of speech in their debates, access to your excellency's person at all seasonable times, and that their proceedings may receive from your excellency the most favorable construction.
So we're listening here to the French, and now we're expecting the Governor General's response.
Mr. Speaker, I am commanded by Her Excellency the Governor General to declare to you that she freely confides in the duty and attachment of the House of Commons to Her Majesty's person and government, and not doubting that their proceedings will be conducted with wisdom, temper, and prudence, she grants and upon all occasions will recognize and allow their constitutional privileges. I am commanded also to assure you that the Commons shall have ready access to Her Excellency upon all seasonable occasions, and that their proceedings, as well as your words and actions, will constantly receive from her the most favorable consideration. Monsieur le Président.
Mr. Speaker, I am commanded by Her Excellency, the Governor General, to declare to you that she freely confides.
That is the Speaker of the Senate just responding as well in French. These are very fixed comments. They are not comments that one writes themselves with their own opinion. These are historic. They are repeated in each government as they come in. And these are just moments before the Governor General's speech begins as we go through these final ceremonial traditions. You can see Prime Minister Justin Trudeau sitting right there. Looks like he's anticipating the speech. Listening very acutely.
I am commanded also.
The justices of the Supreme Court, of course, sitting in the middle in their red robes. We don't often see all of them together like that out, and it's quite a sight to behold. And of course, we can see the military uniforms there too, behind the speaker.
Will constantly receive from her the most favorable construction. Honorable Senators, members of the House of Commons, ladies and gentlemen, my pleasure to address this first session of Canada's 43rd Parliament. We'd like to welcome the 98 new members of this Assembly and to welcome back returning members.
Your predecessors first sat in Parliament in November 1867. Canada was barely 5 months old. On the scale of world history, we are still young. Yet, much of it's happened in the world since then. We have matured, and we are here, strong and free. There has been no civil war, no foreign armies marching on our soil. There have been agreements and differences along the way. And lots of arguments, yes, most of them delivered with much eloquence in this very chamber.
There are many reasons for our stability. First, millions of us share the same desire. Whether we were born here or chose to come and live here, we wish to live freely and in peace and harmony. This quest is a bedrock of our nation and informs almost everything we do. We may differ in many ways, yet we move forward as one people, looking for equal opportunities and common ground. This is not by accident, but by choice. It is who we are.
And remember as well, that our fortunes have relied often on the knowledge and the strategies of the indigenous people, what I call indigenous genius, that allowed this nation to thrive. Their deep understanding of our natural world, their intense sense of community should continue to affect what we do here for the good of our communities and the future of all of our children. Kiji Mkweni, Magani Wiwat, Misiwe Anishnabeg, Achish, Nigan, Abinuchi Shak, Ke Pimadizi Wat. Reconciliation must continue. La deuxième pierre d'assise de notre stabilité.
The second bedrock of our stability is our parliamentary system. Your work is vital because through it, we decide what we really want as a nation. The network of laws and traditions that define what it means to be Canadian safeguards our way of life and paves the way for the future we desire.
Your role in the democratic process is a privilege and a responsibility. I know that you embrace it, respecting the wishes and protecting the rights of us all. Because we serve every single Canadian. Nous sommes au service de tous les Canadiens.
We serve all Canadians, Canadians of all genders, faiths, languages, customs, or skin colors. It is perhaps the most noble undertaking we are entrusted with. And we share the same planet.
We know that we are inextricably bound to the same space-time continuum and on board the same planetary spaceship. If we put our brains, our smarts, our altruistic capabilities together, we can do a lot of good. We can help improve the lives of people in our communities, diminish the gaps and inequities here and elsewhere, and have a better chance at tackling serious and pressing issues like climate change, poverty, inequalities, and human rights. Because global issues know no borders, no timeline, and truly need our attention. Je suis persuadée qu'en travaillant de concert,
I am certain that by working together, no challenges are too big.
Can rise to any occasion. If they are willing to work with others, to reach higher goals, and to do what is right for the common good. Cet automne, les Canadiens ont été appelés aux...
This fall, Canadians went to the polls, and they returned a minority parliament to Ottawa. This is the will of the people, and you have been chosen to act on it. And so we open this 43rd parliament with a call for unity in the pursuit of common goals and aspirations. Here, in this beautiful chamber, we recognize that Canada's Senate is increasingly nonpartisan, and measures will be taken to help it continue along that path. We are joined by the dedicated public servants who have vowed to work tirelessly on behalf of the people. Canadians have sent a clear message. From young people to seniors, they want their parliamentarians to work together on the issues that matter most to them.
In this election, parliamentarians received a mandate from the people of Canada, which ministers will carry out. It is a mandate to fight climate change, strengthen the middle class, walk the road of reconciliation, keep Canadians safe and healthy, and position Canada for success in an uncertain world. These are not simple tasks, but they are achievable if you stay focused on the people who sent you here. Moms and dads, grandparents and students, new Canadians, business owners, workers, people from all walks of life. Every one of them expect their parliamentarians to get to work and to deliver on a plan that moves our country forward for all Canadians, including women, members of visible and linguistic minorities, people with disabilities, and members of the LGBTQ2 communities. While your approaches may differ, you share the common belief that government should try, whenever possible, to make life better for Canadians. That includes better health care and affordable housing, lower taxes for the middle class and those who need it most, investment in infrastructure, public transit, science and innovation, less gun violence, and a real plan to fight climate change while creating good, well-paying jobs. But there are a few areas where this parliament can make a real difference in the lives of Canadians. And as much as they have instructed you to work together, Canadians have also spoken clearly about the importance of their regions and their local needs. The government has heard Canadians' concern that the world is increasingly uncertain and that the economy is changing. And in this context, regional needs and differences really matter. Today's regional economic concerns are both justified and important. The government will work with provinces, territories, municipalities, indigenous groups, stakeholders, industry, and Canadians to find solutions. Grâce au dialogue et à la
With dialogue and cooperation, all regions of this country can overcome the challenges of today and realize their full potential in the modern economy. As the government pursues an ambitious plan to move Canada forward, parliamentarians can draw inspiration from Canadians themselves. Canadians have elected you to do important work, and they model, in actions, big and small, how you can be effective parliamentarians. Neighbors helping neighbors. Putting community first. Finding common ground. Forging bonds. And working together. It is in that distinctly Canadian spirit of collaboration that the government and this parliament will build on the progress of the last mandate and deliver a better Canada for all Canadians.
Canada's children and grandchildren will judge this generation by its action or inaction on the defining challenge of the time, climate change. From forest fires and floods to ocean pollution and coastal erosion, Canadians are living the impact of climate change every day. The science is clear, and it has been for decades. A clear majority of Canadians voted for ambitious climate action now, and this is what the government will deliver. It will continue to protect the environment and preserve Canada's natural legacy, and it will do so in a way that grows the economy and makes life more affordable. The government will set a target to achieve net zero emissions by 2050. This goal is ambitious, but necessary for both environmental protection and economic growth. The government will continue to lead in ensuring a price on pollution everywhere in this country, working with partners to further reduce emissions. En outre, le gouvernement
The government will also help to make energy-efficient homes more affordable and introduce measures to build clean, efficient, and affordable communities. Make it easier for people to choose zero-emission vehicles. Work to make clean, affordable power available in every Canadian community. Work with business to make Canada the best place to start and grow a clean technology company. and provide help for people displaced by climate-related disasters.
The government will also act to preserve Canada's natural legacy, protecting 25% of Canada's land and 25% of Canada's oceans by 2025. Further, it will continue efforts to reduce plastic pollution and use nature-based solutions to fight climate change, including planting 2 billion trees to clean the air and make our communities greener. And while the government takes strong action to fight climate change, it will also work just as hard to get Canadian resources to new markets and offer unwavering support to the hardworking women and men in Canada's natural resources sector, many of whom have faced tough times recently. Canada's experience proves that economic growth is the surest way to maintain a good quality of life for citizens. Over the past 4 years, Canada has seen tremendous growth. And through it all, the government has worked to ensure that all Canadians benefit from Canada's economic success, cutting taxes, reducing poverty, and creating over 1 million jobs. And in this new mandate, the government will provide even greater support to the middle class and to the most vulnerable Canadians by pursuing tax fairness, continuing to invest in people, and growing the economy. As its first act, the government will cut taxes for all but the wealthiest Canadians, give more money to middle-class family and those who need it most. The government will also act on housing. After drastically reducing poverty across the country in the last mandate, the government will continue its crucial investment in affordable housing. It will also make it easier for more people to buy their first home. The government will give families more time and money to help raise their kids and make before and after school care more accessible and affordable. It will cut the cost of cellular and wireless services by 25%. It will strengthen the pensions so that many seniors rely on and increase the federal minimum wage. Understanding that an educated Canada is a successful Canada, the government will give more support to students, be they new graduates struggling with loan repayment, or be they heading back to school mid-career to learn new skills. Le gouvernement continuera aussi de mener un programme économique.
The government will also continue delivering on an economic agenda that will grow a modern Canadian economy. This means moving forward with the new NAFTA to maintain a strong and integrated North American economy. On this and other trade agreements, those in the supply management sectors will be fully and fairly compensated, with many farmers in the dairy sector receiving their first checks this month. To ensure fairness for all in the new digital space, the government will review the rules currently in place. The government will remove additional barriers to domestic and international trade for businesses and farmers, continue with ambitious investments in infrastructure, and reduce red tape so that it is easier to create and run a startup or a small business. And the government will pursue a reasonable fiscal plan to keep the economy strong and growing.
Every single person in Canada deserves a real and fair chance at success. And that must include Indigenous people. In 2015, the government promised a new relationship with Indigenous peoples, one that would help deliver a better quality of life for their families and communities. Real progress has been made over the past 4 years, including the elimination of 87 long-term drinking water advisories, equity in funding for First Nation K-12 education, the passage of historic legislation to protect Indigenous language and to affirm Indigenous jurisdiction over child and family services, and the completion of the national inquiry into missing and murdered Indigenous women and girls. But we know that there is still much work to do. Reconciliation with Indigenous people remain a core priority for this government, and it will continue to move forward as a partner on the journey of reconciliation. Indeed, when Indigenous people experience better outcomes, all Canadians benefit. Among other things, the government will take action to co-develop and introduce legislation to implement the United Nations Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples in the first year of the new mandate. Continue to work of eliminating all long-term drinking water advisories on reserves by 2021 and ensure safe drinking water in First Nations communities. It will co-develop new legislation to ensure that Indigenous people have access to high-quality, culturally relevant healthcare and mental health services. And it will continue to work to implement the Truth and Reconciliation Commission's call to action and the National Inquiry into Missing and Murdered Indigenous Women and Girls' call for justice in partnership with First Nations, Inuit, and Métis people.
The government will work with Indigenous communities to close the infrastructure gap by 2030. It will continue to move forward together to ensure that Indigenous peoples are in control of their own destiny and making decisions about their communities. It will take new steps to ensure that the government is living up to the spirit and intent of treaties, agreements, and other constructive arrangements made with Indigenous peoples. It will ensure that Indigenous people who were harmed under the discriminatory child welfare system are compensated in a way that is both fair and timely. And it will continue to invest in Indigenous priorities in collaboration with Indigenous partners. The path to reconciliation is long, but in its actions and interactions, the government will continue to walk it with First Nations, Inuit, and Métis peoples.
Wherever they live, in small rural communities or in big cities, in the foothills of the Rockies or the fishing villages along our coastlines, in the far north or along the Canada-US border, all Canadians want to make Canada a better place for themselves, their children, and their communities. But there are challenges in making that better future a reality. Year after year, headline after headline, Canadians have seen firsthand the devastating effect of gun violence. Too many lives lost, too many families shattered. It is time to show courage and strengthen gun control. The government will crack down on gun crime, banning military-style assault rifles and taking steps to introduce a buyback program. Municipalities and communities that want to ban handguns will be able to do so. And the government will invest to help cities fight gang-related violence. Nous sommes aujourd'hui à la veille du 30e
Today, we are on the eve of the 30th anniversary of the horrific killing of 14 women at L'École Polytechnique in Montreal. Day when all Canadians pause to remember and honor those women who were killed because of their gender. And we take stock of the harm that gender-based violence continues to do to Canadian society. The government will take greater steps to address gender-based violence in Canada, building on the gender-based violence strategy and working with partners to develop a national action plan.
Ensuring a better quality of life for Canadians also involves putting the right support in place so that when people are sick, they can get the help they need. The government will strengthen healthcare and work with the provinces and territories to make sure all Canadians get the high-quality care they deserve. The government will work with provinces, territories, health professionals, and experts in industry and academia to make sure that all Canadians can access a primary care family doctor. The government will partner with provinces, territories, and health professionals to introduce mental health standards in the workplace and to make sure that Canadians are able to get mental health care when they need it. And the government will make it easier for people to get the help they need when it comes to opioids and substance abuse. Canadians have seen the widespread harm caused by the use of opioid in this country. More needs to be done, and more will be done. Too often, Canadians who fall sick suffer twice. Once from becoming ill, and again from financial hardship caused by the cost of their medications. Given this reality, pharmacare is the key missing piece of universal health care in this country. The government will take steps to introduce and implement national pharmacare so that Canadians have the drug coverage they need.
Finally, the government will continue to recognize its solemn duty to those who choose to serve in the Canadian Armed Forces. In the last mandate, the government invested more than $10 billion to deliver better outcomes for Canada's veterans. And in this new parliament, the government will build on that work by improving mental health care supports and by helping ensure that every homeless veteran has a place to call home.
Canadians expect their leaders to stand up for the values and interests that are at core to Canada's prosperity and security: democracy, human rights, and respect for international law. Canadians expect the government to position Canada and Canadians for success in the world. As a trading nation, the government will seek out opportunities for Canadian commerce, ingenuity, and enterprise. As a coalition builder, the government will build partnerships with like-minded countries to put Canada's expertise to work on a global scale in areas like the promotion of democracy and human rights, the fight against climate change and for environmental protection, and the development and ethical use of artificial intelligence. Le Canada est un allié.
As an ally, the government will contribute to multilateral efforts to make the world more safe, just, prosperous, and sustainable. The government will renew Canada's commitment to NATO and United Nations peacekeeping. It will stand up for the rules-based international order when that order is put in question, particularly when it comes to matters of trade and digital policy. And it will continue to ensure that Canada's voice is present at the UN, notably on the UN Security Council. Finally, as a compassionate partner, the government will provide targeted resources for international development assistance, including investments in education and gender equality. It will help the world's poorest and most vulnerable people live better lives and become strong partners for Canada in turn. Parliamentarians, Canadians are counting on you to fight climate change, strengthen the middle class, walk the road of reconciliation, keep Canadians safe and healthy, and position Canada for success in an uncertain world. And with goodwill, humility, and a willingness to collaborate, you can do just that. You can raise the bar on what politics is like in this country. After all, the government knows that it needs to work with other parliamentarians to deliver results.
The mandate of this recent election is a starting point, not the final word. The government is open to new ideas from all parliamentarians, stakeholders, public servants, and Canadians. Ideas like universal dental care are worth exploring, and I encourage Parliament to look into this.
Whether it's fighting money laundering or making parental benefits tax-free, there are good ideas across parties, and this government is ready to learn from you and work with you in the years ahead. Some believe that minority governments are incapable of getting things done, but Canada's history tells us otherwise. Canada's Parliament is one of the most enduring and vital institutions in the democratic world. It has delivered a tremendous way of life for the Canadian people through crisis and prosperity, through majority and minority governments. On December 31st, 1966, Prime Minister Lester B. Pearson welcomed Canada's centennial year and lit the centennial flame in front of the Parliament buildings for the first time. In his remarks, he said, "Tonight we begin a new chapter in our country's story. Let the record of that chapter be one of cooperation and not conflict, of dedication and not division, of service, not self, of what we can give, not what we can get. Let us work together as Canadians to make our country worthy of its honored past and certain of its proud future." In this 43rd Parliament, you will disagree on many things, but you will agree on a great many more. Focus on your shared purpose, making life better for the people you serve. Never forget that it is an honor to sit in this Parliament. Prove to Canadians that you are worthy holders of those seats and worthy stewards of this place. Members of the House of Commons, you will be asked to appropriate the funds to carry out the services and expenditures authorized by Parliament. Honorable members of the Senate and members of the House of Commons, as you carry out your duties and exercise your responsibilities, may you be guided by divine providence.
What we're watching now, the speech has just wrapped up. We've had an opportunity to hear the priorities of this government. And what we're watching right now is the preparation for another procession. This will be the procession that leaves. There are a great many processions on a day like today, with all of the history and ceremony and pomp and circumstance that goes into this. And we are going to see now the procession leaving the Senate chamber. And they will proceed back to the House of Commons. This is, of course, some of the MPs, the usher, the speaker. There they are. And there will be 6 days of debate following the throne speech. So as they head back, let's go to our David Akin, who is standing by. He's at the Senate chamber, and he's had a chance to listen to this speech, to process it. And he will be joining us in just a moment. We have to wait for this procession to clear through there before we can go to him. But we had some themes that we were, I think, largely expecting. We heard about climate change. We heard about Indigenous reconciliation. We heard about health and safety, which interestingly was a combination of gun control and pharmacare. Under one umbrella, we also heard about a renewed commitment to peacekeeping and NATO missions. Interesting, because the government had promised that in 2015. They really hadn't done a lot on peacekeeping in particular. There was one mission with two rotations, very limited number, and no sign of a new commitment on the horizon. But I believe David can join us now. David, you listened to that speech. What stood out to you as the key points?
Well, it's really a you can have your cake, Canada, and you can eat it. We're going to do everything. We're going to be aggressive on fighting climate change, a commitment to getting to net zero on emissions by 2050. Wait, there's more. We're going to cut your cell phone bill by 25%. Wait, there's more. You're going to get a huge income tax cut. Wait, there's more. We're going to bring all our laws in line with the United Nations rights, UNDRIP, the rights of Indigenous peoples. And I'll read you this line to remind you, all that as they pursue a responsible fiscal strategy. Something's got to give here, folks. I don't think that we can have our cake and eat it all here. It's going to be in the implementation. Let's take pharmacare right off the bat. There was the commitment to pharmacare in here. That's great for the NDP. They want that. But don't forget, the Bloc Québécois earlier today, their leader, Yves-François Blanchet, saying he's going to stand up for Quebec. Quebec doesn't want any part of national programs. It wants the cash. It'll want to opt out and do its own. Will a Liberal government do that? Liberal governments traditionally have been very inflexible federalists. Conservatives may be a little more flexible. I mean, that's just one hurdle. So lots of aspirational stuff in here, that all sorts of stuff on the broad things, I think a lot of parties can agree on. But again, the devil's definitely going to be in the details. And again, all due to do that in a responsible fiscal strategy. That's going to be tough.
Richard, you've had a chance to listen to the throne speech, and we've had a chance to read it now that it's out. We've all been going through it and making notes. How do you think the government did on this first foray out to show their intentions?
I think pretty well. I mean, as my colleagues have observed, speeches on the throne are, you know, very general and high-principled things. But I thought it struck the tone of humility that I think Canadians were looking for and the government was trying to do. It certainly struck the tone of collaboration. Those common ground words that said, as we said here before, that there's a lot actually, in spite of our view that there's a lot to divide parties, and we see that in the election campaign and the attacks, there's a lot of common ground. So that in minority parliaments have had, some of our minority parliaments have worked and given us some of our great social reforms in the country. You know, it won't be easy work, and it's much easier to have a majority, but there is no reason why, if people that of goodwill put their minds together, that you can't achieve some pretty ambitious programs. And I thought, I guess the last thing I would say is they did set out their five themes: Indigenous reconciliation, safe and healthy communities, helping the middle class, sort of Canada's position in the world, and climate change. All five of those things were in there, and there was probably enough meat from a speech from the throne sort of standard for us to say, okay, well, they've got some things to put in their budget, they've got some things they got to fund, they've got some work to do with the opposition parties. I thought they did their job today.
Emily, a lot in here for the NDP. Do you think that Mr. Singh and the NDP caucus will be satisfied with what the government has offered up in terms of collaboration?
I mean, I think there's a lot of positive signals. Again, it'll really come down to what the details look like, but absolutely, I mean, really thrilled to hear a commitment to implementing the United Nations Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous People, you know, building on the lead of the BC government recently enacting legislation, signaling, you know, take it with a grain of salt, but signaling a willingness to look at things like dental care, something that really resonated with a lot of voters during the election. No doubt, I think it went even beyond tone. It was almost a a little much with the collaboration work together. Oh, by the way, let's also collaborate. And also, to me, had a little bit of a tone of kind of finger wagging at the opposition as well. Like, remember, we all need to work together here. But, you know, I think that's what Canadians want. So, it's nice to see that. It's not surprising. We all kind of saw that.
Never forget that it's an honor to sit in this parliament. Prove to Canadians that you are worthy holders of these seats and worthy stewards of this place.
Right, and invoking Lester B. Pearson and really,
they want to prove that themselves as well going forward.
Best given to yourself as well.
And I think that's kind of one of the really important key points, because this is a prime minister who does like to talk a lot about listening and consulting and collaborating, but doesn't always execute those things as well as a lot of people would like. So, it's one thing to say, I'm listening, but are you hearing what people are saying, and are you actually acting on the feedback that you're getting? So a lot of these things will be to look at. I'll admit I was a little surprised to see a reference to the space-time continuum and the planetary spaceship.
Earth is a spaceship, yes.
Apropos maybe with
coming
from the Governor General.
Was that a reference to Elizabeth May?
Maybe.
Did she make a comment like that on the campaign trail?
She did talk a bit about this, planetary spaceship, but also with the Governor General herself having had a previous career as an astronaut, kind of maybe made some sense. But interesting little flourish there for sure.
That has nothing, that was not in any way, didn't come from legalization of marijuana, those kind of continuing things. I don't think that's where it's from.
I just want to throw to David for a moment because he has some official conservative reaction. He is with Aaron O'Toole. David, take it away.
Well, I don't know if it's official conservative reaction, but it's certainly the reaction of a conservative. I'll put it that way, Aaron. You saw the speech. I described it as a you can have your cake and eat it too kind of speech. A lot of things that everybody wants, but to do it in a responsible fiscal strategy. I guess the details will be in the implementation?
It's all about implementation. They sprinkled a bunch of stuff around, no detail. It sounded more campaign-like. Mm-hmm. And on some of the things like climate change, we'd be willing to see a real plan. Reducing emissions is important, and the tax is not the only way you're going to do that. So really they have to start talking substance, not just green jobs and sort of platitudes. We'd like to see some real tangible plans that a minority parliament could work on.
And of course it is a campaign in the sense it's looking for 338 votes now instead of 33 million. The one thing that I noted was the first thing we're going to do, I think that was the phrase, our first act will be a tax cut. And I know that's something your party campaigned on as well, as a broad income tax cut. Could you see conservatives supporting tax relief?
We'll have to see that. Certainly there was a number of things where it seemed like they were going to do that, but then they said they're excluding some people. They also made reference to tax fairness. And the last time they used that line, Minister Morneau, who just walked by us, is when they attacked small business and had these proposals that brought small business owners, family businesses, entrepreneurs up in arms about their future. They don't have a pension. All of their stuff is tied into their small business or their farm. So that whenever I hear the Liberals promise a lot of spending and then say we're going to work on tax fairness, it usually means they're going after small business. So we will have to see. Certainly affordability is something all parties talked about in the last election, but we also need people working in the private sector. And this is the big thing I don't see from this government. There was literally nothing on the economy apart from talk of the middle class. Well, middle class people need good jobs first and foremost.
All right, Aaron O'Toole, Conservative MP from Durham, congratulations on your re-election and good luck in the 43rd Parliament.
Thank you, David.
All right, we'll take it back to you, Mercedes.
Thanks, David, and thank you, Aaron. I want to throw to Fred. Fred, this is a speech that had a lot in it, I think, if you're the NDP or the Greens. Maybe not a lot for the Bloc, but largely staying out of Quebec. I didn't get the sense that there was a lot in here for the Conservatives. It seemed to be a choice to lean, as we expected, more left towards progressive than right towards conservative.
Yeah, Mr. Trudeau's looking at the House of Commons and realizing where he's going to get his allies from, and he's showing to us it's not the Conservative Party. He doesn't want to work with Conservatives. We've been talking about national unity being a major problem right now, a major issue, an economic-driven issue in Alberta and Saskatchewan with the oil sector, and there was not one mention of oil, gas, or pipelines in this speech. And this is an issue that affects all Canadians across the board. I'm from Nova Scotia. There's a lot of family and friends that depend on work out there, and they're hurting right now across the board on this. So this is it is disappointing to see this, that Mr. Trudeau has, it appears he's abandoning this issue, and he's not willing to work on this.
And Richard, I was a little bit surprised that we didn't hear anything about that. The other thing I didn't think I heard a lot about was Alberta and Saskatchewan. They've been talking a lot about the outreach there and making those provinces feel included. If I'm looking through this speech, I'm not sure that I saw a lot that really jumps out as an olive branch to those provinces.
Yeah, no, I mean, again, speech on the thrones are not particularly specific. They are more sort of attitudinal and principles-based. But I would say a couple things in response. There was talk of unity in there, and that the common ground and the need to work together, that could be applied to folks in the prairie provinces. On the issue of oil and gas, the speech from the throne did say, underline its commitment to much more ambitious climate change targets, net zero by 2050, and said at the same time, we'll be dogged with the same degree of energy towards natural resource projects. Just today, Minister O'Regan, who is the Minister of Natural Resources, put out an announcement of the progress on building TMX. So there are literally pipes on the ground about to go in the ground to build a new pipeline. So I don't think it's right. I think our viewers should know that that project is going ahead and is being built by the Government of Canada. It wasn't the Government of Alberta that took over the TMX pipeline. It wasn't the Government of Saskatchewan that took it over. It was the Government of Canada that did that.
But I think some of the feedback that we hear often from our viewers out west and the frustration is that that is a passing reference to one pipeline. And
yes.
I don't think anybody believes that TMX will be enough to save the oil industry.
No.
So there wasn't anything beyond that. Is that a problem, or is that the decision that this government is taking about the path that they will remain committed to that one pipeline, but there is not going to be further development?
I think there'll be further development, but I think where you will see, this is a prediction, where you'll see the government is trying to work with the provincial governments out there to help not only the adjustment in terms of to renewable energies, but finding ways to better extract those things. Obviously, a pipeline to tidewater is one key thing, but as you suggested, that's not going to solve all the problems. There is a world price of oil problem that is not created in Canada and is not something that we're going to have to work around. We're going to have to find ways to extract that are both more cost efficient and more environmentally benign. That work's being done. There's people in the sector doing that work right now. But there are some things which are beyond our control, one of which is it is a high emission resource, and secondly, we have a problem with the world price of oil. At the price we have right now, it is hard to get the investment that we need in Western Canada to get the kind of prosperity that we used to have out there.
Well, I know at Global News, our Dallas Flexhog, who's out in Calgary, has been in Texas looking at the number of Canadians who have moved there and followed oil down there, and they're not looking at coming back in many cases. But I want to turn to one other key issue in this speech, and that is pharmacare. And Emily, there is this mention of it, and I want to go exactly back to what the government had to say about it, because it's very clear. I'm going to flip to it so we get it exactly. The implementation of national pharmacare so that Canadians have the drug coverage they need. They say it's the missing piece of universal health care, but there's a lot of different versions of how pharmacare could look and no commitment to one. What do you make of how broadly they've defined pharmacare? Because it could be only for those who need it most. It could be universal pharmacare, since they've said universal healthcare, but they haven't said universal pharmacare. How do you interpret that?
This is exactly what they did during the election campaign as well. They were very slippery with language, happy to let people think they were talking about universal single-payer pharmacare when actually they're a little bit vague, and I think that vagueness is persisting here, so that it will come down, I guess, to negotiations with the provinces, with other parties. It would have really been nice to have seen a firmer, more direct commitment to the kind of pharmacare that New Democrats are advocating for. So to me, this is the same kind of mealy-mouthed language that they hope will give confidence to people that are looking for universal health care, that they hear the word or pharmacare, they hear the word universal, they hear the word pharmacare. But I do think, you know, we need to be cautious when we're looking at that commitment, because I wouldn't characterize that as the kind of commitment that New Democrats are looking for. But nor does it exclude what we're asking for either, right? So it's sufficiently generic that I guess it gives them something to build on. But this is where I think we need to be particularly cautious, because we've been down this road before with Liberal governments in the past.
And I want to pause for just a moment here on our panel to go to David Aiken, because I know David is in the Senate. David, you have another special guest with you. Who are we speaking
to
now?
Yes, I do, Mercedes. Joanne Roberts is the interim leader for the Green Party, and Joanne ran in the last election in the riding of Halifax. Not successfully, I know you were hoping, crossing your fingers.
Yes.
But generally a very good election for the Greens.
Excellent.
And you've just been in the Senate listening to the Speech of the Throne. And the Green Party and Green supporters were looking for a few things, including some commitment to adopting the UN Declaration of the Rights of Indigenous Peoples. Why was that important for Greens?
Very important. I mean, we can't talk about reconciliation unless we have this overarching legislation that was introduced in the last parliament and did not succeed in getting through. We're really pleased to see the Prime Minister bring it back. We've seen Greens help get it introduced in British Columbia. That is a very exciting step forward, and it will frame our legislation going forward.
And in fact, in British Columbia, BC Premier John Horgan was just here at the Assembly of First Nations. They got blanketed because people were very pleased about that. The commitment to make sure we get to net zero emissions by 2050. We've seen the Liberals promise to be green before. Are you confident they can do it?
Well, obviously, we're pleased to see so much of a mention of climate change in the throne speech. We even like the title, Moving Forward Together, which was our slogan in the campaign. We wish they'd just taken our target as well as our title, because our targets aren't there yet. He's hinting at it. The throne speech is hinting at it. I mean, we got specifics on cell phones. We got specifics on the number of new water treatment plants. We did not get a specific target. That's disappointing.
All right, Joanne Roberts, the interim leader of the Green Party. We're going to see Joanne around Parliament Hill a little more. Back to you, Mercedes.
Thank you, David. We're going to go live now to the foyer of the House of Commons, where Andrew Scheer, the Conservative leader of the opposition, is reacting to the throne speech.
Talking about preparing Canada for a potential economic downturn with many warning signs on the horizon. Nothing about our energy workers in Alberta and Saskatchewan. Nothing about our forestry workers in British Columbia. No sense that decisions that were taken in the previous parliament under this government have caused some of the very damage to our society and to Canada. And most importantly, nothing really on national unity. Nous avons une crise de l'unité nationale dans cet pays avec la résurgence du Bloc québécois. And in Western Canada, sentiments that that under this Liberal government, that Confederation is not working for them. But luckily for Canadians, there is a party that is still going to fight to put Canadians first, that still believes in a united Canada, and that there is still someone running for Prime Minister who will put Canadians first, and who believes in uniting Canadians, not dividing them. So over the course of tomorrow, when I respond to the throne speech, and over the course of the next few days and well into this parliament, the Conservative Party will be showing Canadians how a Conservative government will keep Canada united, help Canadians get ahead, put their needs first.
Mr. Scheer, you heard what? You heard
the throne speech and potentially triggering an election then?
We are very disappointed in this throne speech. We are going to be moving an amendment to it, and we'll see what happens with that amendment.
Mr. Scheer?
We'll be tabling that tomorrow when I give my response to the throne speech. It will highlight the things that we believe should have been in this speech, the missed opportunities that Justin Trudeau had to send the signal that he gets it, that he's heard from Canadians. That wasn't in the speech that we saw today, so we will be proposing that.
Monsieur Trudeau parle, le discours du trône parle bien de l'importance d'amener les ressources naturelles vers les nouveaux marchés. Il mentionne ça spécifiquement. C'est pas suffisant pour vous?
Non, parce qu'il n'est pas nommer le secteur énergétique et aussi il n'a pas reconnaître le fait que c'est son propre pièce de législation avec 179 et 148 qui a causé le problème. Et je crois que les Canadiens ont besoin de voir un signal qu'il a pris une leçon de l'élection et c'est clair qu'il n'a pas.
Mais très clairement,
est-ce que vous allez voter contre le discours du trône et quelle sera votre stratégie à partir de ce point-ci?
Pour aujourd'hui, pour demain, on va proposer un amendement et on va voir si le Parlement adopte notre amendement.
There's only one brief mention of the resource sector in the entire speech, no mention of Alberta or Saskatchewan. What is this government's message to Canadians in those provinces?
It's an extremely negative message. Justin Trudeau has caused the damage that is affecting our natural resource sector, our oil and gas sector. Billions of dollars of investment have left Canada, have left the energy sector to be invested in other countries. This notion, this idea that Mr. Trudeau likes to put about that there's some, that the people of Alberta and Saskatchewan are victims of a global phenomenon is just false. Billions of dollars have left. They're being invested in other countries. Businesses are going out of business. They're going bankrupt. And they're selling at auction their equipment to American companies to build pipelines and invest in the energy sector in the United States. So today's throne speech was, I believe, an insult to the people of Alberta and Saskatchewan for not recognizing the anger and the sentiments that exist there.
Right. Do you think this is going to drive deeper those concerns about separatism growing, especially in Alberta?
I am worried that Mr. Trudeau's entire approach is sending a very negative signal to many parts of this country that he doesn't understand the feelings that exist in several provinces. Luckily, the Conservative Party stands ready to show Canadians how we will ensure that Canada works, how we will put forward concrete proposals that bring our country closer together. We believe in a united Canada, and we will work very hard.
Do you think the first amendment have anything to do with Alberta?
You'll see our amendment tomorrow when we
want to do it. Do you support a concrete example for today? So you're saying you have concrete plans, but you can't tell us what they are right now.
Concrete plans for...
We want to put forward concrete examples of how you would do better. Can you give us example today?
Absolutely. Repealing Bill C-69 and Bill C-48. Starting the work for a national energy corridor that will address the environmental and First Nations concerns so that we can get big projects built in this country again. Elements of our environmental plan that would accelerate investments in research and technology, helping the energy sector grow while at the same time reducing emissions. We had we have many of those types of ideas, and you'll see more of them in the weeks.
Do you support any of the?
Il y a aucune province de mentionner dans le discours du trône. Alors pourquoi il aurait fallu qu'il en mentionne une idée?
Mais on a deux problèmes. C'est une en l'ouest du Canada, mais au Québec aussi. Mais il y a des nouveaux députés bloquistes parce qu'il y a un nouveau sentiment au Québec pour appuyer une partie souverainiste. Je crois que, peut-être pas nommer 10 provinces et 3 territoires, mais donner un signal aux Canadiens que le gouvernement, que le premier ministre savent qu'il y a un problème aujourd'hui dans ce pays.
Do you support anything in their climate plan specifically? Is there anything in what the Liberals are saying on climate change policy-wise that you support?
I did see a mention to something that we had proposed around attracting investment around business development, about investments in technology. We'll see what that looks like. Obviously, in a throne speech, you don't see all the details, but there was a mention to that. So we'll see where they go with that.
Ça fait deux fois que vous nommez le Bloc québécois. Pourtant, ce n'est pas eux qui menacent l'unité nationale, à ce que je comprends actuellement dans le portrait actuel du Canada. Ce sont plutôt les provinces de l'Ouest, l'Alberta en tête, avec le mouvement séparatiste. Alors, pourquoi revenir avec le Bloc québécois et non pas avec ce mouvement séparatiste de l'Ouest?
Mais il y a des députés dans ce Parlement qui a été élu sur une plateforme de l'indépendance, ça c'est clair. Nous avons proposé aux Québécois et Québécoises des mesures concrètes lorsqu'on va respecter le Québec, donner au gouvernement de Québec plusieurs pouvoirs dans la matière de la culture et de l'immigration. On a proposé une seule rapport d'impôt unique. Nous avons proposé des mesures spécifiquement. M. Trudeau a rejeté beaucoup de ces idées. Alors, c'est clair que le Parti conservateur pour améliorer la situation avec les sentiments autour de l'unité nationale.
Oui, mais les Québécois aussi ont rejeté vos idées. Vous avez perdu 2 sièges et votre nombre de votes en chiffre absolu a diminué au Québec. Alors, en quoi votre solution est meilleure que celle de M. Trudeau?
Quand nous avons une situation où il y a... le Bloc québécois était... presque fini pendant 2 parlements. Et maintenant, avec Justin Trudeau comme premier ministre, après 4 ans, ils sont ici encore. Alors, mon travail, le travail de notre équipe pour les prochains quelques mois, c'est de montrer aux Québécois et tous les gens, tous les Québécois et tous les gens du Canada dans chaque région que nous pouvons gouverner cet pays en respectant toutes les régions et toutes les provinces. We will show over the course of the next few weeks and months, for as long as this parliament may last, or as short as it may last, how a conservative government will govern this country in the best interests of every province and every region. Justin Trudeau has divided this country. He has divided this country. He has pitted region against region. That is not the way to keep this confederation together, and we will show Canadians a better way. Merci beaucoup. Thanks very much, everyone.
Take care.
That was... Andrew Scheer, leader of the opposition. Pretty strong response there, Fred. I don't think there's necessarily a strong likelihood that we were expecting the Conservatives to vote in favor of this, but is it safe to say that based on what you're hearing from your colleagues, and I know you're connected on your phone and everything else, and what you heard there from Mr. Scheer, that there's no chance the Conservatives are going to vote in favor of this, even if it means they try to recruit allies to try to bring down the government, which is unlikely,
right.
But that seems to be the tone and the strategy.
Yeah, there's no way they would vote for this. I've been getting a lot of emails and notes from colleagues around the block, and people are very upset by this. This is a symbolic speech. There's an opportunity here to throw olive branches, to do something, and Mr. Trudeau completely missed that. That there was nothing here for the West is striking. It was so easy to put something into this, and there's a lot of upset people over this. Yes, Mr. Scheer came out very strong, and rightfully so, on this.
Richard, we were talking about this, and you said there was the one passing reference. They talked a lot about unity, but why the duplicate messaging? On the one hand, you're sending Chrystia Freeland out, and they're saying there is no bigger issue for us than national unity right now, than talking to Alberta and Saskatchewan. But if you're in Alberta or Saskatchewan listening to this, and you don't hear it mentioned, you hear the North mentioned, you hear other parts of Canada mentioned, you don't hear your area mentioned, I'm surprised there wasn't at least maybe one small paragraph somewhere dedicated to it.
So I think in one of the questions that Mr. Scheer got there is the answer to that, which is, you know, we have 13 provinces and territories. The speech didn't mention any one particular province or territory. It talked about all Canadians. So it's talking about uniting everybody, no matter where you live. Number one. Number two, Mr. Scheer is, it's a bit rich for him on this day particularly to try and pin these things on Mr. Trudeau as if he's created them. Number one, he and his allies have done much to fan the flames of Western separatism and Wexit for their own narrow political purposes. So I think their job today, Mr. Trudeau's job, Mr. Scheer's job, is not to fan them. And I think that's one of the reasons why there's caution in the speech on the throne on acknowledging those things. What they're going to try to do is to work on issues which actually people across the country agree. We do need to have action on the environment. We do need to have action on making life affordable for the middle class. We do need to have action on growing the economy. And so, and as I said earlier, just today, the Minister of Natural Resources announced the progress on the build of Wexit. Our biggest problem in natural resources isn't the fact that we're starting to do something about climate change. Our biggest problem is our biggest market, the United States, stopped buying from us. And the reason why they stopped buying from us is because they now buy it from themselves. They have fracked, they've built up self-sufficiency in oil and gas, mostly through fracking. And that's why we need to get a pipeline to Tidewater, because we need to sell that to someone else other than the people that have been buying it from us for the last 50 years. So, the last thing I would say is you're right. I mean, we have to judge Mr. Trudeau and his government by their actions. Dispatching Ms. Freeland across the country is important. His own meetings are important. But really what's going to be most important is what they do between now and budget time and now and over the next 6 months to deal with those issues.
Emily, what was your take on should they or shouldn't they have mentioned the issues, particularly with Alberta and Saskatchewan?
I have to say I was surprised not to see something a little more substantive there. I mean, I think there was a reference to regional economic concerns, which are both justified and important, probably could have been a little bit more specific to really make Albertans and people in Saskatchewan feel like they're actually being heard and not just as one of a number of regions with economic concerns. I'm a little surprised not to have seen kind of a bit of a bone, something a little bit more than just, yeah, we know that you're struggling economically, but not actually offering a solution. You know, at the same time, you know, I would have expected, maybe a reference to something like a just transition. I can understand why they don't want to be using that language, because they don't want to be signaling to people any further that their industry is winding down, even though given global realities, that's probably the case. But I have to say, I agree completely with Richard's assessment, too, of Mr. Scheer's comments. I mean, I think it's hugely rich to come out and say, Mr. Trudeau doesn't seem to have taken the signal from the electorate. I mean, he doesn't, and in the past several weeks, I think he has really shown a complete tone deafness to what Canadians, the message Canadians sent to all parliamentarians in the last election. And to say, you know, I'm not here to be divisive, while at the same time just being enormously divisive, essentially using language like we're still in an election campaign, I think it's going to be really interesting to see what he does and whether he does have intentions to actually try to take this government down sooner than people might have thought, maybe in particular given his own political concerns in terms of his leadership of the Conservative Party.
Well, that's it. That is the reality. He is still in a leadership campaign, or in a campaign. It's for his leadership.
That's
He's
right. It's
for
his survival.
Yeah. Yes. We have 5 months to go, roughly, until Conservative members will decide whether he remains leader or not. So he needs to be showing these cards now. At the same time, he does have to look like a diplomat, so there are some give and take on this. But that's what's driving him right now.
But I don't think he's succeeding on that latter point at all. I mean, I understand the signal. He wants to still show that he's there to fight for people and to stand up for these issues. But at the same time, he doesn't come across like a real leader when he's making statements like that, in my assessment.
Richard, I'm curious to know, part of what we heard him talk about was the amendments, and this is common. The opposition party will put in amendments. In a majority situation, those are very rarely taken.
Right.
It's kind of go, yeah, that's nice, fish, off to the side, unless it fits their agenda. They have to think about that a lot more in a minority. Mm-hmm. What do you think the chances are of the government seriously considering some of the amendments that might be put forward by the NDP, by the Bloc, by the Conservatives, by the Greens in this parliament? Will we see them try to actually incorporate those into the throne speech?
So I think it depends on what they are. I think it depends on what they are. If they are, as Mr. Scheer just indicated, you know, scrapping the new environmental assessment bill, C-69, no, that won't. I don't think that will get support not only from the Liberals, but from other parties either. But if it are things that the government feels they can live with, number one, I don't know if it'll happen on this speech from the throne, because there may be enough for other parties to vote against this, and I'm sure Mr. Scheer wants to vote against this, and other parties will vote for it. But I suspect that either the next one or in the budget, we will see a public example of what you just said. You see something where the government puts forward idea one, and the NDP or the Bloc or the Conservatives or the Greens propose an amendment, and the government quite visibly accepts it. Because that is, I mean, it happened, I remember, in the when Mr. Martin was Prime Minister in the minority budget, the famous meeting in the hotel room with Jack Layton and so forth, and that, you know, the budget was actually changed, and it was acknowledged that it was changed. It was changed by the meeting and the coming together of two parties. I think that'll happen in this parliament. Whether it will happen on this speech from the throne, I don't know. There may be enough for other parties to support it there without amendment. I'm not sure.
Yeah, I don't think the other parties would use their political capital necessarily on a speech from the throne. It is, to your point earlier, about the budget bills and when you get into that.
It's unlikely the government comes down on this. Everyone wants to wait a little while. Despite what Andrew Scheer is saying, I can't imagine he desperately wants to go back into an election campaign.
I'm sure he does wants to go back to a campaign.
Really?
Yeah,
he
does. Well, that gets rid of the leadership review quickly, right?
Ooh,
right.
I guess that is one way to do a leadership review at a whole new level.
But he's not going to get... The other parties are going to prop up this government some way or another for the next 2 to maybe 4 years.
And as you suggested, I think he's got because he has a leadership review issue, he's got a challenger for him. He's now playing to the base of the Conservatives who don't like Mr. Trudeau. I think that's fairly clear. And so rather than playing to Canadians who are probably going to want to see a bit more of the kind of water in their wine and how them all work together, I just wanted to know if Fred knows. I heard a rumor that maybe that a number of his fans in the Conservative caucus had written in Mr. Scheer for Speaker, because he was a former Speaker. Is this true? Did this happen?
Well, a subtle way of saying we would like you in another role, job? Perhaps?
I would have liked to have seen an opposition member in that role.
Right.
I don't think Mr.
Scheer was the right one. Yeah, okay. Fair enough.
Let's go back to our David Akin, who is over at the Senate. David, one of the key elements that we heard in today's throne speech, which surprised me, was Canada on the international stage, because the government talked about this a lot in the 2015 election campaign. They hardly had a peep about it in 2019. They are on a number of NATO missions, including Canada is currently running the NATO mission in Iraq. We're in Latvia. We're in a number of other countries. We have over 1,000 troops deployed. Not so much on the UN front. They had promised 6,000 troops initially to the United Nations. They were very excited about that. They only ended up getting a couple of hundred who went to Mali. They flew, I think it was just over a dozen missions during the year that they were there. And yet they've chosen to make this a pillar of their speech. What did you take away from that, David?
Yeah, I was a bit surprised about that, too. And you've just listed off some very good reasons. And here's another good reason. It's a minority government. And the general rule of thumb is, you know, in a minority, you don't have time to do foreign policy. That really the focus is going to be on domestic issues because everybody is really focused on the next election. So that was the first thing that I found a little surprising. But then here's the other thing, Mercedes. We have been watching this. The Liberals, I think, still have it in the back of their minds that they can somehow win a seat on the United Nations Security Council. And the campaigning for that is going to get hot and heavy now. And the Liberals are going to have to show or try and show the world that they're committed somehow on an international stage. We may hear some talk about increases in the official development budget as a way to expand our influence. So really, that's about the only thing that I can think. Why would they include that? Why would they talk about that? I don't think the Conservatives are going to give the Liberals many props for that sort of thing. And we know that the NDP is not exactly thrilled about military adventures, maybe peacekeeping, who knows. Same thing with the Greens. And again, it's a real non-starter for the Bloc. So yes, a bit puzzling to see that in there.
And just so our viewers know, at any moment, we are expecting to hear in English from Bloc leader Yves-François Blanchet. He's speaking right now in French. Well, as soon as we have him in English, we will jump in and go to him, of course, because the Bloc going to be one of the prime allies in propping this government up. Richard, were you surprised to see that foreign policy plank? Because it just didn't jump at me as something we were expecting based on what the Liberals had been saying in the election campaign.
I liked your analysis of it, frankly, which is, yes, it's consistent with what they I've talked about for 4 years in campaign in 2015. It didn't really come out of the hullabaloo of the 2019 election. I think that the, you know, there's another issue there, which I think is Canada has a pretty important place in the world to lead on some issues. And one of them is certainly environment and climate change, where the world needs some leadership. That means we're going to have to do more at home. But I think part of where that comes from, I agree with David's notion that it probably has something to do with the Security Council ambitions in Canada.
Which it doesn't sound like Canada has a great chance on recently.
It sounds like, I don't know this to be true, but it sounds like for reasons that aren't directly related to Canada, per se, or are whether we're qualified to be in the Security Council, that we may be ruled out. But they know
well,
more about that than we do.
There were some Liberal policies, I think, that raised questions and frustrations on the Security Council, including our commitment to peacekeeping after saying 6,000 troops and then you hand over a couple hundred.
And our really abysmal record on international assistance, our international development funding, falling increasingly far behind our international commitments. I actually had put an asterisk next to the comment in the throne speech about the Security Council seat myself because I had kind of, I was really disappointed in the election that there wasn't more of a discussion. The Prime Minister chose not to participate on a debate on foreign relations, so we didn't really have that. And I was actually wondering whether they weren't going to kind of quietly pack up their campaign for the Security Council because I think a lot of the signals are that we don't have a very good chance of being successful there. So I was quite surprised to see that. And you know, when we talked about how little attention was given to Western alienation in the speech, to see that much of it dedicated to international relations was actually surprising and, from my perspective, a positive signal. But again, it'll be what do we actually do with that?
Well, is this potentially part of the international pressure we've seen on Canada? Because there's been a lot of discussion recently about NATO and the United States being unhappy with Canada's level of defense spending. And the government says, well, we've increased by 70%. Well, that's true if you consider up to 2026. It hasn't increased to date. Yesterday, Global News reported that there was a $7.7 billion underspend in national defense, money left on the table that wasn't spent. Has to do more with the problems with procurement than a partisan intention not to spend, but still there. And the government keeps announcing that money as if they have spent it when they haven't. There is a fighter jet procurement that is years behind schedule and still no sense of when that replacement is going to take place. Oh, the Prime Minister's plane, one of which rolled into the side of a hangar and crushed the nose cone, out of commission till next summer. The second one, which was sent to fly the Prime Minister to London, then broke down as a result of ice bending the blades. There is now one plane that can fly the Governor General, Prime Minister, or troops around that's a significant-sized jet. Does this give you maybe some hope, though, Fred, that they're going to reinvest in the military or speed up that procurement process that maybe we'll have an answer on whether we're getting F-35s?
No, look at the speech from the throne says we're going to renew our commitment to NATO, something we have not been living up to. They have not been living up to at all. But they're putting these words in as if we've always been doing it. It shows how meaningless so much of this speech is.
But in fairness, no government has met the 2% NATO test in Canadian.
No, but they're saying renew our commitment. They're saying we're going to do it.
Right, but the Harper government didn't do it, right. And the Martin Kretschmer governments before them didn't do it. Canadians did, and many Canadians did, and many Canadians died in Afghanistan. The biggest single combat mission of this country since World War II, which was the one time when I forget the clause number, but the NATO clause where if you attack on
Article
one, it's attacking
on
Article 7. Thank you. Expert. Subject matter expert.
Occasionally useful.
Occasionally. Subject matter. It's the only time that has ever been invoked, and that was our largest military presence. So Canadians played with lives and treasure for that. So we do make our commitments. Have we met the 2% spending? No, but there are, as we all know, a lot of competing demands amongst Canadians for that spending, and it's not all for military spending. That is for sure.
Well, do you think that there's perhaps another chance of a significant UN peacekeeping mission here? Because one of the things that this government found when they started looking at putting peacekeepers out, they talked about it. Peacekeeping is not what it used to be. It's not the Suez Canal. It can be extremely dangerous. Mm-hmm. You can lose people. And let's be crass here, politically, minority governments don't like to put soldiers in a situation where somebody could be killed.
Right.
It becomes very difficult. It becomes a very hot political issue when that happens. Emily, do you think there's any chance that they are seriously considering a major recommitment to peacekeeping here?
I mean, I don't know why. I mean, I know there are a lot of things that are said in a throne speech that aren't necessarily followed up on, but given that this wasn't really expected, given that this wasn't really part of their election platform, given that it wasn't something they talked a lot about during the campaign, we have to think that it's there for a reason. And maybe they do have some kind of plans. And again, in the context of a bid for the UN Security Council, they do have to do something. And it's not, like I said, it's not just the NATO spending. It's also international assistance. We're at the very bottom of the OECD in terms of our how far apart we are from our commitment. So, you know, maybe they do have something in the cards. I know there had been an effort to get Canada to extend the mission in Mali. That didn't happen. So maybe this is setting the stage for an announcement coming up, I have no idea.
David, I want to go back to you for a moment. One thing, there were not a lot of specifics, but this was very specific that was in the speech. A promise to cut the cost of cell and wireless service by 25%. Not a path to say how they'd get that, but certainly tells you how much, I guess, that's on Canadians' minds.
Yeah, that's you're right. It's like every Canadian, you know, I'm sure that will be in everybody's lead in newspaper copies, in everybody's newscast tonight. Hey, we're cutting your cell phone bill. Really? How are you going to do that? Well, I'll tell you what the Liberals said during the election campaign was this. We're going to have a serious discussion with the telephone companies about how to do it. And we asked them, well, what if? Would you legislate it? And they wouldn't commit to that. So really, you have to wonder how on earth are they going to do that? I mean, one quarter. And in fact, John Manley, a former Liberal deputy prime minister, who now serves on the board of TELUS, one of those big telecom companies, he was just commenting on this the other day. Well, you know, one of the reasons that cell phone bills are high in Canada is because of the cost of spectrum. In other words, the license to use the radio waves that carry all this stuff is a lot higher in Canada than is elsewhere. So how do you do that? If companies have to buy this spectrum from the government, cost billions of dollars, how are they going to get that back? It's the government that sets that price. So great, I guess everybody going right on. I'm going to have 25% off my cell phone bill. I think people like to do it. That's also aimed, we should point out, that was an NDP idea that they've been floating for a while now. I think Tom Mulcair had that in his campaign back in 2015. New Democrats, when they're successful, it seems to me, really focus on pocketbook, kitchen table issues. I think that's what took Jack Layton to 100 seats, a real focus on transit and housing and everyday cost of stuff for people. So if Trudeau wants to do that, I'm certain he's going to have Jagmeet Singh and the NDP right behind him. And I assume they'll be pressing him to say, okay, buddy, how do you do that? Why don't you just legislate it?
Well, speaking of how to do it, Richard says he has an answer. So I would love to know
okay.
the answer.
Let's hear
to
Richard.
This. How is that going to happen?
So, I mean, David's right, and the government, the Liberals said this in the campaign. There isn't, it is not likely that they would legislate exact fees, but there are lots of regulatory leverage they've got. The biggest one they've got is something that David actually mentioned, it's spectrum. So what the government has been doing over the last couple of years, they started this work, By making spectrum available to new entrants, they effectively began to make cheaper prices available to Canadians in the last year. So that's most of that's still to come because the new entrants have to get the spectrum, they have to deploy it, they have to put towers up and so forth. But instead of giving it all via auction, as John Manley suggests, to the big three, let new entrants in, give them access to spectrum so that we can get more competition in the space. And you can bring down the price of wireless. Most people would tell you that the prices of Canadian wireless are among the highest amongst OECD countries, and there is regulatory leverage that will do it. Whether that will end up saying 25% less to me will depend upon how much that spectrum is sold for, who gets it, who deploys it. But that's one example of how they can bring down, through their own policy, they can bring down the price of cell phones.
Okay, I just want to go to the Bloc leader, Yves-François Blanchet, who is speaking now. And
I'm going to support the speech because I see in that speech many opportunities for us to not to take what is intended to be given because it's not that clear, but to get things, to make some gains for Quebec. And the fact that it is so unclear about oil makes it so that it's hard to vote against something which is not even named in the speech, even if we understand well that this is the intention.
Dernière question.
Ça va être. Il va en avoir deux dans une avant. Vous dites, bon, c'est pas un piège, etc. Mais j'en viens un peu à ce que voulait dire ma collègue. Pas une entourloupette, mais est-ce que dans le fond, vous dites, vous trouvez cette poignée de l'absence du mot pétrole pour vous éviter juste parce que vous voulez pas mourir, comme vous dites.
Écoutez, dans mon bureau, quand je lis les documents, je fais quelques raisonnements tactiques ou stratégiques qui m'appartiennent, puis il y a des bonnes chances que je me les garde pour moi. Mais. Évidemment, si le gouvernement, allons-y par l'exemple clair, si le gouvernement avait dit, nous allons...
So that was Yves-François Blanchet, the leader of the Bloc, saying that he will support the government. Not a surprise. He had indicated before that unless there was something in this speech that went directly against Quebec's interests, he would do so. Now, Quebec, not a big fan of national pharmacare, but they've gotten to do their own programs on other things like the CPP. So I would suspect that since this government wants to stay in power, you might see them offer something similar. And they've indicated in the past that when it comes to pharmacare, they do want provinces to have their own input into how they do that. Another thing that was in the speech that I wanted to talk about was gun control. Yeah. A promise to ban military-style assault rifles. For the many military and police viewers who watch this show, and I get the comments, there is no such thing as an assault rifle. You're talking there about a rifle with a long barrel on it. The type of thing that you would see police officers carry, the type of thing that would be like an AR-15, for those who see a lot of reports on this. Interesting that you would choose that, Richard, because most of the shootings in Canada are not happening with those types of guns. It's handguns.
That's right. And on handguns, I agree with that. And I think there's a reluctance to go whole hog on handguns. But what they did say as well in the speech, as well as in the campaign, is for cities and municipalities that want to do a handgun ban, the government of Canada will allow it.
But how can a city enforce a handgun ban? I mean, especially for the city of Toronto, if the federal government is having trouble controlling handguns coming across the border, how does the city do that? And even some of the mayors have said, look, this is really not something that's going to help us.
Well, if you're pulled over in the city of Toronto and Toronto has a handgun ban and you have a handgun in your possession, I presume, depending on what Toronto legislates, it will be an offense. This is a typically Canadian thing. There's a compromise here, which is, you know, there's a reluctance to allow a national ban.
I'm just going to pause you there, Richard, sorry, because we're hearing that NDP leader Jagmeet Singh is up, and we're going to throw to him to hear his response.
This is not good enough. What we're seeing is a lot of, again, pretty words, but not any concrete actions. We just got through a campaign where people told us that they can't afford their medication. Millions of Canadians are making difficult choices to cut their pills in half or to skip taking the medication they need to stay healthy. We know that so many Canadians cannot find a place to call home, that young people are worried about the future of our planet. There is a climate crisis going on. Indigenous people continue to face injustice, and this government is taking Indigenous kids to court. What do we see in this throne speech? They said the word national pharmacare, but they didn't commit to their own report, which says it should be public and single-payer and universal. No commitment there. They talked about housing, but they said they're going to continue to do what they're doing. Continue to do what they're doing means spending 19% less as a portion of GDP than the conservatives before them. They talk about reconciliation, but they have not mentioned stopping taking Indigenous kids to court. And with a climate crisis, we need concrete action, which means science-based targets with accountability to meet those targets, and also ending fossil fuel subsidies. We've not seen that type of action. Instead, again, we're just seeing the nice words and a signal that they're willing to talk to us. And yes, we're willing to talk, but after seeing that throne speech, we need to talk, because it's not good enough. We need some firmer commitments. We need some real action to tackle the urgent problems that people are facing, not just saying the right words, but following it up with more details. Donc, dans ce discours, le discours du tronc, c'est clair que ce n'est pas suffisant.
Okay, so that is NDP leader Jugmeet Singh reacting, a stronger reaction than I really was expecting, having seen the many things in the throne speech that seemed to go to the NDP. David, you were listening to that as well. What's your take on the NDP leader's reaction to this speech?
Yeah, I think maybe heard Yves Francois Blanchet sound like the BQ is going to back the government up, so he's off the hook. He doesn't need his vote. So what's next? Yeah. Tomorrow there will be a regular question period and sitting. Parliament sits next week, the House of Commons. There's going to be 6 days of debate on this throne speech, likely not until the new year when Parliament comes back on January the 27th. And that means that will be the confidence vote somewhere in February. In the meantime, the first order of business for the government, it's what's called a supply bill. The government needs parliamentary authority to spend money. So that will be is what is on tap next week.
Okay, well, with that, we're going to go to our panel for our final thoughts because we're about to wrap up. I'll start with you, Richard. We listened to this. We've listened to the leader's reaction. Your thoughts overall, how do you rate the government's performance on this and the opposition's response?
I think government did fine. I think what we heard today is you're going to see a pretty tight focus next little while on the first bill will be middle-class tax relief. Then we're going to have some ambitious stuff on climate change. We've got targets to meet in 2030 that we need more work to do as a country. And I thought basically, with exception of what I said about Mr. Scheer, his tone was off a little bit. I think everybody did what they had to do today. And as David said, once the Bloc Québécois said they're going to support it, Mr. Singh was off the hook.
Yeah.
He's off the hook.
Very interesting dynamic there. He's saying this is not good enough.
Yeah, I mean, I think this is in part because of the experience we had with the last government where the words-action disconnect was quite profound a lot of the time. And so, you know, on the one hand, we don't really expect to see granular detail in a throne speech. On the other hand, I do understand where Jagmeet Singh is coming from in that the level of vagueness on a lot of these key things where we were really looking for some kind of signal that the government was listening, you know, weren't there. So, again, I think this is really just reinforcing that what we're going to see in the coming months and years is going to probably be a bill-by-bill debate, attempt to collaborate and seek consensus, and it will be very, very interesting to see what the coming months hold.
It's always very exciting from our perspective
exactly.
When we get to cover a government like that. Fred, your final thoughts on the throne speech today?
Well, to Emily's point, I think this will be a bill-by-bill parliament, potentially. We saw Jagmeet Singh surprisingly come out against this. I thought this was written for him, for the most part. So that was surprising, but he was off the hook, as Richard said, with the Bloc. For Mr. Scheer, he came out very strong. And I see why he did it. He is playing to the base because that's what his main target group is right now. At the same time, though, I think the base wants to see a prime minister in action, and he does need to demonstrate that. And I'm not sure if he did that today.
Well, it's certainly something we're going to be watching very closely going forward. Again, the key elements that we heard in the speech today, climate change, the relationship with Canada's Indigenous people and reconciliation there, Canada's role in the world, a recommitment to NATO and peacekeeping, universal pharmacare, well, not quite universal, but definitely some form of pharmacare, a promise, too, to get Canadians more doctors, cheaper cell phone bills, all kinds of goodies there. A little light on the details, I think everyone would agree, but this sets the tone. How will it proceed in the House of Commons? Something we will certainly be keeping a close look at as this goes forward. 6 days of debate now that we are expecting on this. And, of course, some potential amendments from the opposition parties. Will the government accept them or not? We will certainly keep you up to date on the latest on that right here on Global News. That brings our special coverage for today to a close. We will certainly be keeping an eye on this going forward, but now we know this tone of the Liberal government. We'll have more analysis tonight on all of this on Global National and online at any time at globalnews.ca. For now, we're going to return you to your regular programming. Thanks for watching. We'll be right back.
A message from Her Excellency the Governor General.
I am convinced